Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the fifth meeting of the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee for 2022. This week we are conducting the meeting in hybrid format, with some members in the room and others attending remotely. At agenda item one, we have consideration of whether to take agenda item four in private. Item four is consideration of today's evidence. Are we agreed? That is agreed. Item four will be taken in private. Item two is consideration of evidence on the draft of the Scottish Government's fourth national planning framework, referred to as NPF 4 in short. A number of committees are joining in scrutiny of different elements of NPF 4. Last week, this committee heard evidence on how effectively NPF 4 addresses energy policy. Today we are going to hear from two panels. The first panel, the focus will be on transport, and I'm pleased to welcome the following witnesses who are joining us remotely. Dr. Caroline Brown, Policy Advisor, Transform Scotland. Chiquita Elvin, Head of Infrastructure and Delivery, Sustrans Scotland. David Hunter, Member, Mobility and Access Committee for Scotland. And Paul White, Director, Confederation of Passenger Transport. Good morning, everyone. Thank you very much for joining the committee today. And thank you to those who have submitted submission in advance to the committee, which we are very grateful for. We have just over an hour for this session. We have a lot to cover. We do appreciate complete answers, but also concise answers where possible. Given that, we'll move straight on to questions, and I would like to start with a question for each of you. One of the main themes running through NPF 4 is to prioritise localisation across a number of policy areas. In the context of reaching national net zero targets across all transport sectors, I would like your views on how important will local authorities be in meeting these net zero targets. And what do you see as being the main challenges faced by local authorities in meeting those net zero targets? And if I could put that question to the panel in the order that I introduced you. So first of all, that would be Caroline, then Chiquita, then David, and then Paul. So Caroline, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Really interesting starter question. Clearly, local authorities are crucial in the delivery of these policy targets, because the planning system is effectively delivered at the local level, and NPF 4 guides development plans and decisions made at the local level. So local authorities are critical, and that localisation agenda through 20-minute neighbourhoods is also going to be delivered through local authorities, and the way in which they plan and bring new development forward. The challenges for local authorities are going to be around resources and skills. And so if we consider that the planning system in Scotland is a discretionary system in which developers are able to negotiate policy areas, they are able to negotiate around the things they deliver in new development. In an under-resourced planning system, planners have less time to negotiate those goods, that localisation and the delivery at the local level. So if you're a stretched authority, have developers hammering on the door wanting to bring development forward, and it's hard to push back and deliver things that are different to the way they've been done in the past. And that's a big challenge. We're going to have a skills challenge as well, but I think resourcing is a big area of challenge. And I think the other thing to keep in mind is about the unevenness in space and how we work together at the local and national level to bring consistency between local authorities. So we know there are developers and local authorities that push further and faster with these agendas than others, but we have to bring the tail along in order to achieve those pressing, challenging targets.
Thank you very much, Caroline. You touched on a number of issues there that I'm sure my colleagues will want to explore. Chiquita, the same question to you, please.
Thank you. I would echo a lot of the points that Dr. Caroline Brown made there. I think resourcing and skills are going to be the biggest challenges because, of course, local authorities, it's not just about working with developers, about the sort of projects that they deliver on their own that come out of the local development plans and other local plans. And we've seen similar problems with resourcing and the skills, and that impacts on the speed of delivery. So how quickly can we tackle this? There would need to be further investment and training on delivery. But it's also at the moment, it's just the number of people who are able to carry that out.
Thank you, Chiquita.
Sorry, and that's across the private sector as well, who support local authorities in terms of consultancy support as well.
Thanks very much. Sorry I interrupted you there. David, same question to you, please.
Right. Okay. Third one to mention resources then. I think in the context of the National Planning Framework priorities, one example I'd give to that is that there's quite a lot of emphasis at the moment on kind of active travel freeways, which are part of the strategic transport planning transport projects review, and sort of major active travel routes. But at a local level, the most important thing for many disabled people to get around is just the everyday pavements, the quality of the pavements, the size of the pavements, being able to cross the road, these bread and butter things. So one of the things that I think is really important to make the planning system and mobility work properly is that councils are able to improve the everyday local pedestrian environments, which in many parts of Scotland, really, I think all parts of Scotland, is really very poor and a big inhibition for many disabled people to get about. So resources and the balance between the kind of centrally funded major projects and the local bread and butter kind of walking and wheeling environments is one thing I'd mention. The other thing I would just say, I think, is about we want to see better implementation of public sector equality duties, understanding the impacts of planning projects, transport projects, all kinds of initiatives on disabled people. I know there's currently a review of PSED, the public sector equality duty, underway, and I think we feel that the planning system and indeed transport system hasn't been as effective as it should be in carrying these out.
Thank you very much. David and Paul, the same question to you, please.
Good morning. I'm going to complete the set and also reference resources and skills. Localisation, I think, for in terms of the sector I represent, public transport, particularly bus and coach, we do have positives in terms of the Bus Partnership Fund and means to hopefully improve infrastructure as it relates to public transport. But I think one of the challenges will be learning how to deliver that effectively and expediently and sharing good practice.
Thank you very much, Paul. Let me just follow up with Caroline, because Caroline, you mentioned planning will be crucial to meeting the targets, and the common theme obviously across what we've heard is that resources are limited and challenged. Last week, the committee heard evidence that there's been a 20% reduction in planning officers since 2011 at local authority level. So obviously, the resources are going in the direction of being decreased. To address what we perceive as being the increasing demand from local authority and the planning teams to meet net zero targets, do you have a sort of an idea, a ballpark figure about how much resource, how much more additional resource is going to be required in local government planning departments? Are we looking at, you know, a 10% increase in officers, or are we looking at a transformational change? Are we looking at almost having to double the number of, you know, planning personnel available at local authority level?
I think you really need to talk to the Royal Town Planning Institute Scotland. I think they have figures they've put in their submissions to other committees about this. So I think it is in the order of hundreds more officers, planning officers, working in local authorities. So it is a significant increase, and although some of that may be covered by fee increases in planning, not all of it will. So I think it is a significant change, as you say, quite a significant loss looking back over the last 10 years, and we need to undo that and put new resource in to cover the skills that we need to deliver these changes.
It's very helpful. Thanks very much, Caroline. Let me bring in Fiona Hislop. Fiona.
Good morning, everyone. I want to ask about multimodal hubs, and I'll want to come first to Chiquita Elvin and then to Paul White. Draft MPF4 talks about multimodal hubs where people can easily switch between bus, rail, walking, wheeling and cycling. So I want to know from you what you think needs to happen to make these a reality. My constituency goes halfway from Edinburgh to Glasgow, is in between the M8 and the M9, has lots of towns, is over 100,000, the biggest in Scotland, and lots of commuters. So in reality, how do we tackle this and what needs to happen? So first of all, to Chiquita Brown, please. Sorry, Chiquita Elvin, excuse me, apologies.
That's quite all right. I think integration, network planning at the kind of from the highest level, and I think that this is something that the planning system is very well equipped, a plan-led approach to integrating all these modes. I think accessibility as well, as David Hunter touched on, considering how different people use our spaces and making them accessible to everybody is also key. So broadening our understanding of that and I suppose improving the quality of active travel infrastructure in particularly, and things like bike parking and access to the different, whether it's a station, whether it's a bus stop, even as simple as that, is allowing people to connect all those dots. So a plan-led approach and integration of all the different modes working together.
Could I just ask, who makes this happen?
Sorry, I couldn't quite, we're very quiet.
I wanted to ask, who makes this happen?
Who makes this happen? Well, it's going to take partnership between central government, local government, all the different delivery partners at a regional level, as well, working together, as well as the private and public sectors, and of course the third sector as well. But it needs to be everybody from planners down to construction.
Thank you. And can I ask the same question of Paul White? Obviously, the bus companies in particular have a keen interest in these multimodal hubs. How do we make them happen? What has to happen? And who is responsible?
Thanks, Deputy Convener. That's, as you can imagine, I'm a fan of multimodal hubs. I think there's a lot of benefits that could be realised through this. What needs to happen? Again, I'll be looking through my sort of bus lens here. Primarily, I think we have the formats where we can generate the discussions that are required to deliver these, such as the bus service improvement partnerships that were within the last Transport Scotland Act, where you can bring together the stakeholders that Chiquita was mentioning there. You can bring through, you can involve bus operators, local authority, Scottish Government, other key stakeholders in that, and look to agree a partnership approach, whereas maybe the infrastructure for the multimodal hub is something that is funded by the local authority or through the Bus Partnership Fund, and the operator in turn commits to serving that hub with a degree of frequency or with a standard of vehicle or whatever is required to then hopefully make it a success. I think other aspects of that they have to consider is integration with active travel, also integration with rail, perhaps, depending on what kind of multimodal hub you're referring to. I look at ticketing, and that's something that a lot of operators are already introducing, that integrated ticketing across bus, but can we integrate it with rail? Can we integrate it with the cost of bike hire, for example? And information provision. We've got a good resource in Scotland, Travel Line Scotland, also just informing people how to access these things and how to use them appropriately.
And will the NPF4 help facilitate, enable this, or is it just makes a statement?
I think in terms of NPF4, there are aspects of that where you're looking at the mass transit network, and where you can identify examples of maybe looking to build in those kind of hubs. I also think that in terms of serving new developments and developer contributions, this is something that we should be looking at in terms of looking to make developers part fund these type of hubs, where you have you do not require the bus service that serves any new development to go essentially round the houses, if you excuse the phrase, and serve a hub. and people can access that hub by quality cycling and walking routes, and the bus can be there and away, and you're not massively increasing the journey times or the boarding times that's required, and everyone has a quick and reliable service. So I think there's in terms of MKF4, that's an aspect that I think we should be looking at.
Thank you. And I was wanting to ask the other two witnesses about 20-minute neighbourhoods. And first of all, to David Hunter, 20-minute neighbourhoods are mentioned 34 times in draft NPF4. But from your perspective, how might these be delivered in practice, and you know, particularly in urban and suburban areas, and particularly from your perspective, what needs to be there to make this a reality and positive for different communities in Scotland? David. Mm.
Sure, thanks. It's a good question, the how, because I think that Max has spent quite a lot of time over the past year or so looking at the concept and sharing it with other disability groups, doing a number of webinars and so on. And we're quite enthusiastic about the concept. I think that the how, though, is more complicated, and particularly whether it's a kind of planning-led approach at which kind of local authorities are actually directing these neighbourhoods and facilities in some way, or whether it's a more market-led approach. I think there's a fair bit of work to do about that. But we do think that the more that local facilities and services are close to where people live, are kind of on their doorstep, that's going to make for more inclusive and accessible in environments. So we'd certainly like to encourage them. Whether quite what the levers are to achieve them, I'm still a little bit unclear. If I could, just while I have the microphone, I just wanted to actually compliment your previous question about mobility hubs. Just to say that interchanges are particularly important for disabled people. That if they need to work well, if they're going to be accessible, even if it's something just like having taxis close to railway stations. So that kind of integration of transport modes is really important. And just draw attention to our submission that suggested that transport interchanges should be added to the list of national developments in the NPF4, by which we basically mean bus stations and train stations. So I just wanted to at that point. Thanks.
Thank you very much. And finally to Dr. Caroline Brown, before I hand back to the convener, to ask for your views about 20-minute neighbourhoods and how in reality they can be flexible enough for rural and island communities in particular, and how that might be achieved.
Yes, Scotland has really taken on the challenge here in attempting to apply the 20-minute neighbourhood concept to rural settings. I think examples of other countries around the world that have used this concept have really been mostly urban in their focus. So this is a good question about how it applies. I think there has been quite a lot of dialogue, and there are some hints in NPF4 about the way in which that can be adapted for rural settings. So accepting that 20 minutes, not going to be a 20-minute walk or an 800-metre walk in a rural area, but this idea that there are a network of hubs that provide key services, and that's a much more local offer than perhaps is the case currently. I think we need to have a nuanced understanding of what 20-minute neighbourhoods deliver and the sorts of infrastructure that is present there. We don't just mean having a coffee shop nearby where you can get an iced latte. I think we need to have a more rounded understanding about like travel infrastructure and public transport services, but also social infrastructure, community infrastructure, space for local businesses. And I think this is a really good question about implementation. The planning system already has policies around mixed-use development in urban areas, has done for a long time. And all of you know Edinburgh, and you can probably think of some places in Edinburgh where we have mixed-use developments with flats and residences alongside retail units or commercial units, and those retail commercial units are empty and have been empty in some cases for several years. But there's a question about building it, and then there's a question about making it work. And I think NPF4 and the planning system doesn't have the levers to make it work. So we need to think about how these things work together at local level, at central government level, to animate those spaces, to provide incentives for businesses to come in and actually bring a nursery, a dentist, a whatever, a repair centre or a repair cafe into that community and make it work. And that applies for rural settings as much for urban settings. How do we make it work, even if we deliver the site?
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. Fiona, let me bring in Mark Ruskell. Mark, over to you, please.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. So I wanted to ask you just about the bigger picture here. We've got National Planning Framework 4. We've got the Strategic Transport Projects Review that's just been announced as well. We've got National Transport Strategy, and we've got the budget. In your view, do you think these are all properly aligned? And do they actually respect the transport hierarchy as well? Or are you seeing some differences or some misalignment there? I mean, I'll maybe start with Paul on this one.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you, Mark. Yes, I think my perspective of the STPR document in this planning framework, going back to National Transport Strategy, is that for the sector I represent, this is a fantastic opportunity. I think you're seeing the spotlight firmly placed on sustainable and active travel properly, probably for the first time in a good long while. We see references to the sustainable travel hierarchy throughout the bus circle of growth. I think that there is an alignment there in the messaging around where we need to be focusing on improving our travel network, and it's up to us to now really deliver upon that. I don't see any misalignment. I do see challenges, though, particularly given, you know, for example, the transport strategy is really referencing a pre-COVID world. And as we emerge from that, there'll be discussions about how you interpret elements of that to a network, for example, a public transport network, rail and bus and underground, that is still looking at, in the medium term at least, patronage recovery. And really, we need to be building up that patronage and strengthening the public transport network if we're going to make it an affordable and a comprehensive alternative to the car, which I think everyone in this panel and within the committee is probably in agreement that's where we need to be reducing those car journeys. So I don't see a misalignment, but I do see a challenge.
Okay, thanks. Can I move to Caroline? I mean, I think in the past, Transform has maybe been somewhat critical when it comes to Scottish Government budgets in terms of the transport hierarchy and whether what's in NTS actually materialises when it comes to spending the cash. But what's your thinking at the moment in terms of these critical strategies and capital programmes and how they align or don't?
So clearly, for any of this to work, these big ambitions have to be delivered. And I think that's a key weakness, both in the NPF4 and STPR2, is about how those are delivered and the timeline. NPF4 says really clearly the climate emergency is the priority, that we have to make a rapid and just transition, but we don't have any sense in here about the timescales for delivery or which interventions and projects will deliver the greatest reduction in emissions over time. So we need to start with those first, and I think that's a big missing part of the agenda here, not just in NPF4, but also in STPR2. We can't wait 3 years, I think it is, in STPR2 for a strategy about demand management. We need it now, and we need to start implementing it. And I think that's a big question about how the national projects, the national network, the rapid transit, how those are delivered and over what timescales.
Okay, thanks. And David? Any thoughts?
Sure. I think broadly speaking, the language is fairly similar, and there's a fair amount of consistency between the various initiatives. It's probably quite helpful that there are a number of concurrent consultations going on at the moment such as STPR2 and the 20% reduction in car travel target. What I would say is that we have been quite critical in our comments about the MPF 4 document in not giving as much attention to the reducing inequalities goal that is quite prominent in the National Transport Strategy. And we think that the bits on equality and human rights are really very, very, very weak, very limp, to be honest. It basically says that statutory equalities should be followed, or, you know, it says something very, very timid. And we think that planning policy and transport policy as a whole can be more, much more assertive in trying to reduce inequalities. And as I mentioned, you know, there's lots of kind of bread and butter things, just like the state of local pavements. But although this is maybe not a planning issue, taxis, you know, in many, many parts of Scotland, you cannot get a wheelchair accessible taxi for love nor money. So, you know, bus stops and shelters are just not good enough in lots of places. So I think our focus is really, again, on the kind of tangible delivery side. And I think that there's a bit of a gap between the high level rhetoric, if you it sounds a little bit unkind, but the high level policy goals and what actually happens in the ground and what people see in their local neighbourhoods. And I think that's the real big challenge for all of these strategies.
Okay, thanks. And Chiquita?
From an active travel perspective, I think Scotland is very well aligned just now. We've got the investment coming as well in 2024. However, the main concerns would be around the deliverability again and the resources and those skills to be able to do that. But, and of course, even if we can do that, how are we going to maintain things? How are we going to ensure that they are reliable for people to make those genuine choices and changes in their lives?
Okay. And if I could just stay with you, Chiquita, because I think there's obviously the inclusion of walking, wheeling and cycling infrastructure, I think for the first time as a national development in NPF 4. But I suppose the question is, you know, is that detailed enough? And the same with STPR as well. Is it really clear what it is that the government wants to develop here? Because I think most people look at that and think, well, that's the National Cycling Network, isn't it? But we've got the concept of active freeways, and there's obviously, you know, different sort of levels of aspiration that could be put towards that. So what is it really clear what the extent of that development is and what's required?
I think it is clear in the framework. You know, the NWCWN looks to be both local routes, but also joining up different communities as well. Then we have the whole notion of leisure, and I guess that element of health as well. Once you combine that with creating places and talking about place rather than talking about just active travel or just housing, you start to join all those dots. And active travel is just one element that we need, but it's good to see that it's threaded throughout the national planning framework. So from my point, I think it's clear, but again, it comes down to how do we deliver this?
Mm-hmm. Okay, and Caroline, do you have a perspective on that in terms of what's currently spelled out as a national development for walking, wheeling and cycling?
So, actually, NPF 3 had the National Cycle Network as a national project, and that was delivered through SusTrans and Nature Scots' work and the Canals folk as well. In NPF 4, the network is framed slightly differently towards everyday cycling, and it includes that. And while I take on board Chiquita's point about transport and these the network, if you like, appearing in many places in this document, I think that it does seem a little bit confusing, particularly with this new idea of the active freeways, which isn't mentioned in NPF 4. Presumably that's just a timing issue, but I think some clarification is needed about that. And clarification about the idea that we're building an extensive active travel network, which is about everyday journeys. So from the 20-minute neighbourhood up to the, you know, the city scale and between settlements and places in order to provide that longer distance leisure and tourism possibility. So I think there is room for this to be clarified and tightened up and to make more explicit some of the expectations at the local level about walking and wheeling networks, bringing through David's eloquent point about equalities and the impact of that very local infrastructure on people, particularly people with disabilities. The quality of the pavements and the cycleways in their neighbourhood shapes that. And we should be clear about the benefits that disabled people get from good active travel infrastructure, not just for pavements, but also for bikes, because disabled people cycle too. So I think there's room to tighten this up.
Okay. My final question is just about delivery and the mechanisms we've got for delivery. I mean, I know my own local authority in Stirling, you know, they have a plan for what they want to deliver. It's taken a long time to actually roll that out. And some of that is down to the kind of, you know, traffic regulation orders and system that we have around this. Are there particular kind of barriers there that you would point to which could bust up against the ambition of NPF4? Can I go back to Chiquita on that? I mean, you're obviously, you know, directly involved in rolling out the tarmac on the ground, so.
I'm afraid I'm going to go back to resources as one of the key barriers to delivery, particularly if we want to accelerate delivery. And, you know, looking at tripling the investment into active travel. At the moment, that would be a challenge with the resources that are available to local authorities in particular. So you touched on the TRO process that has slowed things down. I think what we've got in the framework is the government reaffirming their commitment to active travel as a priority for delivery. And that will give local authorities a clear mandate when it comes to delivering big schemes like the ones you refer to. But other local authorities are at a different place and they're still looking at those smaller schemes and making them fully accessible, I think, is one of the challenges that we now have to really tackle.
Okay, any final thoughts from Caroline or David on this? David, do you have any final thoughts on that? If not...
Yeah, can I say...
Sure. Sorry, I just I mean, deliverability is a big issue. I think that's best I could contribute, to be honest.
Yeah, thanks. Kelly? Caroline, are you there? Okay, I think we've maybe lost Caroline. But she can come back in a future answer, maybe. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much, Mark. Yeah, it looks like Caroline has dropped off for the time being. We'll try and make sure that Caroline reconnects. I believe Liam Kerr has a supplemental in this area to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. So, Liam, over to you, please.
Yes, thanks, Convener. I do have a supplemental, but it is for Dr. Brown. So perhaps you could bring me in at the end if she reconnects.
Okay, that's good to know. Thank you, Liam. Okay, in that case, I'll bring in Jackie Dunbar. Jackie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. I think my questions would be for David and Paul in the first instance, but happy to have any thoughts from Chiquita and Caroline if she joins us again. I'd like to ask, do the policies that are set out in the draft NPF4 give sufficient considerations to the travel and accessibility needs for all disabled people and also with people with mobility issues? If not, what would you like to see in the NPF4 and what would you change? Can I maybe go to David first, please?
Sure. Thank you very much. As I've said before, I think we would like to see the equality and accessibility dimensions strengthened much more explicitly in the NPF4. when whether it's major transport projects or planning initiatives, I think there are always opportunities to improve access and mobility, and those opportunities often aren't taken. Just to give a really specific example, which I think we mentioned in our submission, sometimes, you know, there's a development with which there's still a narrow pavement outside, and surely developers should be expected to contribute to decent sized pavements and pedestrian environments to make sure that drop curbs are installed or continuous footways outside places. So whether this is through the kind of technical processes, the Section 75, I think, processes, or through voluntary agreements, we think there's I'd like to really raise the bar in the expectations of how planning developments could improve local environments that shouldn't always be down to the councils, which, you know, as we've heard several times, that often have very limited resources. So we'd like to see that. I think culturally as well, you know, it's not just a question of skills. I think there's also professional cultures. We would like to see just a more imaginative use of more imaginative thinking about, you know, how could we make the local environment more accessible, whether that's about pavements or cycleways or bus infrastructure or that kind of thing. So I think the NPF4, when it's in its final version, would like to see a much, much tougher and more explicit mention of things like understanding the impacts, the equality impacts of measures and the opportunities, not just mitigating negative impacts, but opportunities, because the built environment is so massive that, you know, we've got to change it bit by bit as we go along, and we can't expect councils just to do this from their routine kind of roads and such like budgets.
Okay, if I can just maybe ask a little supplementary there. I think we've spoken about earlier about the developer contributions are negotiated. Is that something that you would like to see maybe strengthened, rather than, you know, so that it's written down that it must happen, rather than that they've negotiated that it will happen? Because I'm aware that sometimes these things are put in place, but it's difficult to then go and find out later on if they've actually been done. Mm.
Yeah, I'm probably outside of my comfort zone, to be honest, in the how exactly that should be done. That's fine. I mean, I think that there are as I understand it, you know, the Section 75 could be used to require investment, and is used, but I think it's too limited. I think that the horizons are too low on that. But if the same results can be achieved voluntarily through negotiation, then as long as the result's good, then I wouldn't really have a problem with that. But maybe more people who are more expert in the processes could see whether the drafting could encourage those kind of opportunities.
Thank you. Can I pass over to Paul now and ask him the same questions, please?
Thanks.
I'd be interested in your take on things.
I instantly have to just bow to the superior knowledge of David on a lot of these accessibility points. I will say that we are keen to work with others to improve accessibility. The bus fleet should be at a stage where it is 100% accessible. I think listening to David and the question you posed, there is that aspect of when NPF4 talks about reusing and conserving buildings and infrastructure, and some of these older infrastructure and it might not be fully accessible, and we need to think about how we ensure that public transport, for example, my sector, has the ability to have access to developments, have access, be able to pull vehicles close to curbs, for there to be drop curbs, for people to be able to use the bus, how we interact with active travel and bike lanes. You will be aware of floating bus stops and the issues they sometimes cause for people who are wheelchair users or are concerned about crossing a bike lane to reach a bus stop. there's And again, when it comes to developers, I think, yes, I think we need to be involved in this, if not receiving developer contributions to ensure that the infrastructure is safe, at least involved at the very early stages of those planning discussions to ensure that the infrastructure, the road infrastructure, is accessible, not only in terms of the for people, but accessible for vehicles, the correct vehicles, or a bus, whatever shape that might be, to get where it needs to get to allow people to board. And the only other aspect I can think of is that, you know, the it's 400 buildings meant to be, you're meant to be able to access a public transport facility within 400 metres. Whether or not that is too much or sufficient, I'd have to, David probably better to answer that.
Okay, thank you. Convener, I'm not sure, because I can't see you because I'm online, if Caroline or Chiquita would like to come back in with any final thoughts. If not, I'm happy to pass back to you, Convener. And thank you very much.
Thank you, Jackie. Caroline Brown is now back online. So, Caroline, did you hear the initial question from Jackie Dunbar?
I did, thanks, yes. And I just wanted to say that I think David's point about NPF 4 being much stronger on equalities and human rights is a good one, and we would definitely agree with that, particularly the understanding of the underpinning inequalities that the built environment currently creates and perpetuates. So I think although the document says things about equalities, it doesn't give any specifics about the types of inequalities or the types of groups that are specifically disadvantaged. And that would be really helpful, because if we don't know what the inequalities are, then we can't do something about them. So we have to start talking about those inequalities. So inequalities for children, inequalities for women, inequalities for people with disabilities, because of the built environment, the way that it's configured and the way that it undermines some of the things that those groups do or could do. So I think that's an important point. And yes, we completely support all of the work around accessibility and, again, paying attention to the everyday settings of the 20-minute neighbourhood and how that supports accessibility specifically for those disadvantaged groups is really important.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much, Jackie. Now that we have Caroline Brown back with us, let me bring in Liam Kerr, who I believe has a question for Dr. Brown. Liam.
Thank you, Convener. Yes, Dr. Brown, just I want to pick up something on a line of questioning that Mark Ruskell was exploring with you. You talked about a lack of strategy in NPF 4 and SDPR 2. Now, we've heard this morning quite a lot about the urban possibilities, but it's difficult to relate a lot of that to the rural setting, or perhaps where bus services can't be run for perhaps for financial reasons, as correctly set out in my view in the CPT submission we've received. Now, the Climate Change Committee says that we need 30,000 public EV chargers by 2030, but we currently have about 2,500. So going back to your comments earlier about the lack of strategy, do you feel that NPF 4 sufficiently accounts for a rollout of EV chargers? And can it facilitate the sort of rollout that we need?
I don't think it does. I think that is an excellent point. I mean, there's a mention of digital infrastructure here. And again, the focus tends to be on the urban rather than the rural. And of course, Scotland is not a largely urban nation. It is a mostly rural nation. So that's a really important point. But I think this is where we go back to some of our previous discussions about multimodal hubs and the possibility of using some of that existing infrastructure to provide those settings. Chargers don't have to simply be near or at the point of someone's residence. They can be in many other places. And those 20-minute neighbourhoods that we're talking about, adapting those for the rural context, of course, means providing the sorts of infrastructure in those hubs. So having centres where you can charge your car, having centres where you can pick up your parcels, go to the library, get healthcare or whatever, those things need to join together. And I think this is where NPF4 could extend the envelope by, as David says, thinking more creatively and imaginatively about some of these concepts and linking them together. So I think there's possibilities there about that. And there's some really interesting transport and energy projects about hydrogen and things that, you know, again, might be imagined, you know, in the future. But we should be aware of them now, because this plan is supposed to be in place for 10 years and to guide us through that 2030 deadline. So yes, more strategy required and a lot more thought and nuance in this document about the rural context. I think that's important.
Yeah, I'm very grateful. Thank you, Convener.
Thanks very much. Liam, next up we have Monica Lennon. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning to our panel. I have a first question here, which I think I was aim at Caroline. I'm glad that you're back, Caroline. We've talked about some of the national developments, and the Anglo-Scottish High-Speed Rail project is one of them. I read an article in the Ferret yesterday, and some concern has been expressed by some campaigners, including Friends of the Earth Scotland, about gas-guzzling high-speed trains, because the current refurbished stock are diesel-powered. So I had a look to see what Transport Scotland are saying, and they say that we plan to replace the high-speed trains by 2030 with zero-emission fleets, and that's dependent on progress with the developing programme of electrification and rolling stock capabilities of battery and hydrogen-powered fleets. So with all of that in mind, Dr. Brown, I wondered what you think about this project in terms of delivering on the aims of reducing car travel and encouraging modal shift, which we've talked about a lot today. And are there other priority or other projects that you believe should take priority instead?
This is really tricky, isn't it? You're absolutely right that there's this issue about timelines, and we've already talked about that, and that's a central concern to Transform Scotland about how we deliver this change, these significant changes in carbon and emissions, in the timelines that we need to do. So 2030 is our first timeline, then 2045. And if we're not getting electrification of those high-speed links until the early 2030s, we're in significant danger of missing our targets. We have to provide these sorts of strategic links, because that's important in relation to replacing and providing a viable alternative to short-haul flying, which of course is much worse in a carbon sense than high-speed rail. So we're in a bit of a bind here, I think, and we do need to step back, as I said earlier, and look at the things that need to be delivered and the timelines in which they can be delivered in order to meet the reduction of emissions targets that have been set. So which projects do we need to do first? And I think if we did that, and if Transport Scotland did that with the Scottish Government, then perhaps some of the investment could be directed towards these types of very long-term but strategic projects, which will help us shift away from short-haul flying, for example. And that's really significant and really important.
Thank you, Dr. Brown. That's really helpful. My next question, I think I'll aim at Chiquita and Paul and David, if they have a view. I think Mark Ruskell already covered the need to align different strategies. So kind of on that same kind of a theme, the Scottish Government's Trunk Roads Investment Programme has a planned expenditure of over £7 billion, but it's not mentioned in the draft NPF4. Do you think it supports the spatial principles and the priorities set out in the draft NPF4? And if not, how could the two be brought into alignment? And Chiquita is on my screen, so I'll come to you first.
I don't know that I'll be able to add too much to this. From an active travel perspective, obviously investing in roads wouldn't be our priority from a Sustrans perspective. We need to think about modal shift. We need to think about road space reallocation. And we also need to think about the impact that the roads that we do need, you know, once we start looking at rural areas, for example, the speeds of the traffic on those roads and the impact that that has. So I think we need to really think about people making those everyday journeys and think about streets being for people rather than for the vehicles that are on them, and bringing the place focus back to the centre of all the different strategies. That would be my view, sorry.
That's okay, thank you. And maybe come to Paul to get a bus and coach perspective on that.
Thanks, Monica. Well, clearly there are series of interurban services and bus services that use the motorway network. I'll say from government strategy point of view, I know within the budget for the Bus Partnership Fund, there is money for a managed motorways project. I would say that work on that, the discussion around priority for public transport on motorways has been slow. And I think I would say that probably the Scottish Government has to really set an example if it wants local authorities to then make brave decisions around road space reallocation within city centres, if Transport Scotland is shying away from those kind of brave decisions that it needs to make and elements of its motorway network. Other than that, there's not much I can really talk to around the trunk road budget that the government has.
That's okay. I wonder if David has a view. I know that maybe Caroline would want to come in, so if there's time, convener, I'd like to come back to Caroline.
I think from Max's point of view, you know, we're probably not focused so much on the trunk road network and the decisions, balancing the spending decisions. But what I would say is that there's a massive kind of legacy of inaccessible infrastructure. You know, if we just look at railway stations, for example, in Scotland, the number that you cannot cross from one platform to another that make them inaccessible to disabled people or many disabled people. So I think we have to kind of try to balance those objectives, the accessibility and inclusion objectives, with investment in roads infrastructure. Obviously, you know, there is just a massive legacy of inaccessible transport infrastructure in Scotland, and I suppose our priority would like to see that at the top.
Thank you, David. And Caroline.
Thanks. Yeah, this issue about budget and spending is really important, and we've talked before about delivery. And just to put this into context, you're talking about £7 billion being spent on trunk roads. But if we contrast this looking back to NPF3, the investment in the National Cycle Network set out in NPF3 has been around £50 million. So we can see the scale of investment in active travel is but a button compared to these massive mountains of money going into trunk roads. And I think we need to be really clear, to deliver emissions reduction, to deliver health benefits, improvements in air and environmental quality, significant investment in active travel would repay us in spades. When we see figures like this, we know just how much money there is for transport infrastructure. And if we directed even a relatively modest proportion of that £7 billion into that national cycle network, into those active freeways, then we could do very quickly something very dramatic. And as a final thought, I would encourage the committee to have a look at the sister organisation in Wales. Transport for Wales is doing some very interesting work, and they have essentially stopped investment in roads in Wales because they're concerned about the climate impact, and they're re-evaluating many of their roads projects. And I think there's a really great model to look at.
Thank you, Caroline. We're always keen to get recommendations and extra homework. Got a very brief final question, which I'll aim at David, because I know time is brief, and I will declare an interest as the patron of Disability Equality Scotland. There's been a lot of discussion in Parliament previously when we looked at the planning bill about the role of access panels and whether they should have statutory status in the planning system in terms of how decisions are made. Is that something, David, that you have a view on? And given what we've heard today about embedding equality and inclusion in planning, do you think there is a stronger case now, perhaps, than there was a few years ago to properly recognise the role of access panels?
Yes, I think that would be the answer. That they're incredibly valuable. Obviously, that they are not. It's not very consistent across the country. Some are more active, but my experience with access panels is that they perform an absolutely fantastic kind of grassroots perspective on all kinds of things about planning, transport, and any way to support them or to give them a kind of stronger status. I would really encourage.
That's helpful. Thank you for that, David. I'll hand back to the convener.
Thank you very much. Monica, I believe Liam Kerr has a supplemental to follow on. Liam.
Yes, thank you, convener. I'll direct just a question to Paul White, but based on the line of questioning that we've just heard from Monica Lennon. Your submission, Paul, the CPT submission, talks about the need for bus services to receive ongoing funding, absent which operators will need to make some very difficult decisions on fares and routes and frequency, for example. Now, this committee is doing an inquiry at the moment into local authority ability to support net zero. And one of the things that we know is that there are significant cuts to local authority budgets coming. So noting that, is there sufficient recognition, whether in the NPF 4 or more widely, of what central government needs to do to prevent those negative impacts that you mention in your submission?
Thanks, Liam. I think the point from the submission was within NPF 4, it talks about essentially facilitating bus services that would then do without the need for further public sector support. And our point is that all local registered bus services receive from Scottish Government the Bus Service Operators Grant, which is shortly to be retermed the Network Support Grant. So that there is a form of support that continues, that is continuous. I think maybe what the wording of NPF 4 would probably need to be tightened up to talk about a lack of further support, whether that be from developer contributions or local authority funding to support a service that in its infancy required support, but then could hopefully quickly transition to a commercial service. I think operators are keen to run non-supported services where possible, and in cities that's maybe 90-95% of the bus network is ran commercially. sorry, Ms. Kay, can you repeat your question? Just I feel like I've gone off on a tangent.
No, I think that was an interesting answer. I mean, really, what my question's around is, given that local authorities are facing some severe funding challenges, do you think that, given your submission, that central government recognises, when you say, look, there must be an understanding that any bus route, new or existing, will receive ongoing public sector funding, do you think central government has sufficiently recognised that, whether in NPF 4 or more widely, to satisfy the aims that, as you pointed out earlier on, we're all trying to get to?
I think I would say that Scottish Government has supported the sector through the pandemic, which has been incredibly vital to ensure we have a comprehensive bus network for those essential journeys that had to happen. Looking at the moment, we are looking at patronage levels at about 70% of pre-COVID levels. So there's still a need for a government to provide transitional support as we build up to pre-pandemic levels of patronage and beyond. I think that government support for bus services is tangential to the aims of NPF 4. I think what is more important is that we focus on the relationship between bus operators and local authorities and other key stakeholders to really address the where we can release real benefits for bus operators, which is in tackling congestion. Congestion has been a huge cost to the sector over the last 10 years. We've seen journey times increased by 10%. This leads to increased operating costs. At a time when patronage and commercial revenue is down, tackling those operating costs by freeing buses from congestion, by looking at the aspects of the MPF4, which talks about mass transport networks and a focus on public transport, I think that's where I'd like to see MPF4 really, really, really focus on. And the issue of support for bus services, some will have to remain supported services where they're not commercially available, but essentially Scottish Government does provide that support currently, and it's tangential, I think, to the aims of this document.
Very grateful. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Liam. Let me bring in Natalie Dawn. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good morning, panel. Yeah, I'm interested in the discussion around the importance of equality issues, and some of this has been touched on in response to my colleague Jackie's question, but I would like to expand. Obviously, 20-minute neighbourhoods can mean very, very different things for different people, and I understand the sentiment that we need to reaffirm what a 20-minute neighbourhood is. Dr Brown, I think it was yourself that stated it's not just about being able to nip out for a coffee, but it's about enabling people to meet the majority of their daily needs. So, for example, needs can be a very different thing for a young person in comparison to, say, for example, a pregnant woman or an elderly person or a parent with young children. And out with that, not necessarily a physical or mobility issue, but there's also the element of families on low incomes, which needs to be recognised. People obviously have a whole range of different needs, and this relates both to infrastructure and services, but transport really is key in that. So to ensure these neighbourhoods are accessible for all, how do you think these needs could be highlighted more, and how might this be incorporated into the planning, and especially in a rural setting, like we touched on earlier, the difficulties with that? Can I direct that, first to Dr Brown, please?
There's a lot of things in there.
I realised that was quite a long question.
Yeah. I think, as I said earlier, being more explicit and understanding the current inequalities and how they serve different groups would be a really good starting point. We don't have any mention of that in this document, and I think possibly that's something that's missing from the general piece about the concept of 20-minute neighbourhoods and how it might affect those groups that you talked about, children and pregnant women and older people, folks on low incomes. I think those are really important. And if planners, designers, practitioners are going to deliver 20-minute neighbourhoods, they need that understanding. So having that set out is important. But transport, local accessibility, it is about providing that high quality network of walking and wheeling opportunities. So well-designed, well-maintained streets with, paying attention to the dropped curbs, the crossings, the way in which the vehicle becomes a guest, that should be what we're aiming for, so that, we're thinking always about pedestrians and people on wheels, not people in cars, and we're not providing for vehicles. So there's a lot of retrofit and reconfiguring to go on in order to do that. And that probably falls outside of much of the remit of NPF4, which is about setting that high-level policy. It's down to those nitty-gritty, everyday details, I think. Stop there. I'm sure there are other people that want to come in, but I think there's a lot to explore in this equalities and through into design, and as you say, not only in the urban, but in the rural setting.
Thank you, Dr Brown. I'll bring in Chiquita next, please.
Thank you. Dr Caroline Brown's answer was very comprehensive there, so I would reiterate all of those points. The ability for different groups to feel safe in their environment, particularly when it comes to walking and wheeling, I think needs to be explored much more because of the lack of understanding about how different groups access infrastructure. Access to good quality green space as well for young people in particular can be a challenge in urban settings. It comes back to the skills when we start to look at who will be designing and delivering many of the improvements and the infrastructure that will be required. There's a lot of work to be done. When it comes to the national developments, they should all be fully accessible, and I think a bit more focus on that and what that actually means would be very helpful.
Thank you, Chiquita. I'll bring David in next and then Paul, if you've got anything to add. Thank you.
So I think this point about sort of having maybe examples or illustrations about the impacts and opportunities for kind of having inclusive local neighbourhoods is really quite important. The impact on children, on older people, as well as disabled people. And maybe the document could actually include some case studies or something like that that should can kind of bring that to life. Because I think that's one of the things that maybe doesn't come out of the document as it is. In terms of we've talked quite a lot about the local pedestrian environment, which is something I'm really kind of passionate about and keen to see improved. Notice that Disability Equality Scotland did a poll about 20-minute neighbourhoods a year or so ago, and the key kind of scepticism that many disabled people expressed there was that it's all very well having things on your doorstep, but can I get across the road? The pavement's not accessible for me, etc. Final point just about sustainability is one thing, I think this came up in a previous point, that it's one thing having the kind of infrastructure there, but is a business of some sort, whether it's a local corner shop, you know, is probably the most important sort of 20-minute neighbourhood facility, you know, is that going to be, it's fine designing a space for that shop, but is it going to be, is it going to be economic? So how are these 20-minute neighbourhoods going to survive economically? And there's clearly big issues there around kind of out-of-town shopping centres and competition from other areas, which is very much a planning issue. So I think that we need to look at how these 20-minute neighbourhoods and the services and facilities which are in them are sustainable economically, so that we don't just kind of design neighbourhoods that then become kind of wastelands, which we see quite a lot in certainly in urban Scotland, that, you know, you have little shopping centres and half the units are empty because people aren't making money out of them. And why aren't they making money out of them? Well, partly that could be the quality of the public realm, but it's probably also that there are other more attractive economically out-of-town shopping centres and so on. So I think there's an awful lot of thinking to be done about how the whole package works sustainably. And I mean principally there kind of economically sustainably. But the final point just about that is that I think the other point that maybe hasn't come out so much in the discussion is it's about community sustainability as well as just kind of like physical accessibility. If people kind of live together in they don't have to move out at different stages of life because they can't sustain their life as they get older, for example. But, you know, that's the most kind of sustainable type of community where you have different age groups, different groups of people who are all part of a community that functions well. And that's an economic and a social aspect as well as one about physical access.
Thank you, David. Paul, if you have anything to add.
I probably have little to add after the great contributions there from the other panellists. I would say that in terms of 20-minute neighbourhoods, I think there is an important role for bus in sustainably linking these neighbourhoods, providing access to wherever your education or your employment might be based. And I think it's important that we build that in. And it's not really a planning issue as much as I would say maybe for equality and accessibility information provision is something that is it springs to mind, and we've seen examples of information provision improving through the pandemic where people can look online and see how busy their buses are, whether there's a wheelchair space free, that type of aspect. And I think that might provide surety for people who maybe have accessibility issues that there are sustainable transport options available for those longer journeys where walking and cycling wheeling isn't possible, and also that they are able to access those both in terms of physically access it and feel safe and know there's a space for them on that vehicle.
Thanks, all. It's really, really important that we get this right. So I appreciate all your comments on that matter. Just to sort of round off, can I ask, I'll ask the full panel, are there any other specific transport-related improvements you think could be made to draft MPF4 that have not already been highlighted in our evidence session today? And Paul, I think you've been last quite a few times, so I'll bring you in first. I'll just go the opposite way this time. Paul, thanks.
I quite like going last. You hear the other good comments. The one thing that stood out to me from discussions actually brought up earlier today was something I think Dr. Brown was pointing out about the charging infrastructure. And we've touched on the difficulty of introducing some of these concepts in rural areas. Looking ahead at the desire to decarbonise and providing sustainable transport links, particularly in rural areas, there are specific challenges for public transport provision and decarbonising that. We're in a rural setting where loadings are generally lower, less people use them, but the end-to-end journey time is actually longer, they're long services. And so if you're looking for an electric solution to that, you need to have access to charging infrastructure, but not only at the depot, but at the end of the route, wherever that may be, and back. That also goes for sustainable tourism, which comes up in NPF4 and sustainable tourism travel. I think coach plays an important part in that. And so access to charging infrastructure for those vehicles, taking groups of 70, 75 people in one vehicle to see some of the great things we have in the Highlands. And I'd like to see more focus on how we deliver that charging infrastructure across Scotland and how it's made accessible, not only for people who have a private vehicle, but also for those kind of mass transit vehicles.
Thanks, Paul. Can I go to David now, please?
I did mention before, but just to say that our submission suggests that transport interchanges, maybe slightly different to the mobility hub issue, but obviously related, is something I think we should see, so that every town should have a decent, accessible and high quality bus station or train station.
All right, thanks, David. Chiquita, and then Dr. Brown, just to finish off. Thank you.
Thank you. I think we welcome much of what is in there, particularly for the national walking, cycling and wheeling network. But going back to Paul's point about charging and maintenance, you need that for bikes as well. You need good quality bike parking, and that shouldn't just be focused on people in flatted developments as well. Different types of homes need different types of bike parking. And I think the maintenance question, again, we need to ensure that whatever is delivered can be used reliably by people throughout the year.
All right, thanks. Thank you. Dr. Brown, thanks.
Thanks. Yes, like others, I think there's lots of good things in here. We'd like to see, as I said earlier, clarification of the active freeways idea and the national cycling and wheeling network idea, which has shifted since NPF3. But I think there's something we haven't talked about, which is about infrastructure first, which is a new principle that's out in NPF4. That is a welcome one. But we would like to see that go further so that new development is infrastructure led. If we have new housing planned, we need to have the walking and wheeling network in early. We need to have the public transport links in early so that the people that go and move into those houses have options from day one. It's no good having a bus link or a rail link that opens after 5 years, or some cases 10 years. You can't shift people's behaviours at that point. So I think that's something worth thinking about here, about strengthening that infrastructure first idea into infrastructure led. That is critically important for active travel and public transport.
All right, thanks all. I have no further questions, so I'll pass back to the convener.
Thank you very much, Natalie. For a brief final question, I'll pass over to Mark Ruskell, please.
Yeah, thanks, convener. I mean, it's actually on the back of Liam Kerr's comments earlier around local government funding. I mean, we've seen dramatically increasing capital budgets for walking, cycling, wheeling infrastructure over a number of years now, but that is being delivered via Sustrans to local authorities. So local authorities are kind of bidding effectively for it as ring-fenced. This is maybe an unfair question in a way, but is that the right balance, or do you think more money needs to go from those pots directly to local authorities to build the capacity to actually do the work, to build out the plans? Or is the current kind of model of delivery via SusTrans the best way to do it? Because effectively relying on national charity to deliver a national network. Chiquita, that's perhaps a hard one for yourself, but could I ask Caroline and then Chiquita if you've got any sort of thoughts that you may be able to share with us on that?
Yes, it's funny. We had a conversation about this very question the other day when I was preparing for this session. Why isn't Transport Scotland, why doesn't Transport Scotland have a role here? We can see that it delivers strategically on other types of transport infrastructure. So why not on cycle and active travel infrastructure? And I also mentioned the point earlier about unevenness and where things are left to local authorities and where we have this bidding into a pot. The danger is that some authorities become very good at that. They have the skills and resource to do it, and they successfully develop networks. But the neighbouring authority, which is perhaps less resourced, doesn't. And the people living there, the citizens of those places, don't benefit from that funding and those infrastructure developments. So I think we have to, you know, we have to think seriously about that, about the delivery of this. And NPF4 doesn't say anything about delivery of the National Cycling and Wheeling Network and who was going to be responsible. It did in NPF3. And I think there should be a strategic role for Transport Scotland on active travel, and we'd like to see that. That's one of our suggestions. SusTrans has done a cracking job in many ways, but as you say, it's a third sector organisation. And as more public funding is going towards active travel, who should be looking after that and coordinating it as strategically with those local authorities to deliver what we need for the emissions reduction, the car vehicle kilometres reduction targets that have been set by the government.
Yeah. Chiquita, do you have any thoughts you're able to share with us on that?
Well, clearly this is a bit of a difficult one for me, because I do feel that the money coming through Places for Everyone Fund in particular, the reason that it comes to us is that we are uniquely placed to add value to all of these projects, and we provide support for the local authorities, who are the main delivery partners, though we do work with other organisations as well. Our focus is on the quality of active travel infrastructure, and so we work with them. However, being a charity, we're still working towards the aims of the active travel framework. And I think that there should be increased investment going direct to local authorities. But equally, I think the investment coming through Places for Everyone is very effective as well.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you very much, Mark. That brings us to the end of our time. Let me thank the panel members for joining us this morning for a very interesting discussion. The committee will share its findings with the LEAP committee on NPF4 towards the end of this month. Let me suspend the meeting to allow the second panel to join us. Thank you again to the panel. Enjoy the rest of your day. Thank you. This has got John Muir, yeah. Rosie Simpson. Right, I think we're all set. Are we good to go, everyone? Okay, good. Welcome back. We will now hear from our second panel of the day on NPF4. This panel will focus on the natural environment, waste management and the circular economy. I welcome to our panel Anna Bezic, Programme Manager, Adaptation Scotland, Ian Gulland, Executive Director and Chief Executive Officer, Zero Waste Scotland, Rosie Simpson, Senior Policy Officer, John Muir Trust, and Bruce Wilson, Public Affairs Manager, Scottish Wildlife Trust and representative of the Scottish Environment Link. Thank you all for joining us this morning. It's a pleasure to have you in the committee meeting. As with the previous panel, we have just over an hour for this session, so while we do very much appreciate complete answers, concise answers are also very welcome. Let me start by moving straight on to questions, and I have a question for each panel member. One of the main themes running through NPF4 is to prioritise localisation across a number of policy areas. In the context of reaching national net zero targets, across the natural environment, waste management and the circular economy, how important will local authorities be in meeting these targets, and what do you see as being the main challenges faced by local authorities in this context? And let me put that question to the panel in the order that I introduced you. So that would be Anna first, followed by Ian, Rosie, and then Bruce. So Anna, over to you, please.
Great, thank you very much. Thanks for that question. So my work focuses on supporting wide ranges of organisations to adapt to the unavoidable impacts of climate change. And we are clear that local authorities have an absolutely crucial role to play. The impacts of climate change, so changes in temperature, changes in rainfall, severe weather events are not going to be felt evenly across Scotland. It's not like an average change. The impacts are played out and vary widely across the country. So it's really important that local authorities and regional partners play an active role in understanding the kind of risks they face and are equipped and enabled to respond to those risks to address in a way that is aligned with local culture and values as well.
Thank you very much, Anna. We'll come back to some of those issues later on, I'm sure. Ian, same question to you, please.
Yeah, thank you, convener. Thanks for the opportunity. So, I mean, I think I've said many times, I think local authorities are hugely important in delivery of national targets, but also delivery of infrastructure on the ground to support the shift to a more circular economy. So, specifically thinking we're serious about moving our approach to waste further up the hierarchy in terms of reuse and repair and remanufacturing, I think there's a huge opportunity for local authorities to develop accessible infrastructure for both citizens and businesses and support economic development at a local level for businesses in that space, as well as engaging with citizens and providing a kind of an enabling role for the specific citizens that they have in their communities, whether that's the urban environment in cities or the rural environment, will be very different. Absolutely. I think one of the challenges is still the idea of a circular economy is still very much embedded in the kind of waste management part of local authorities. We need to raise that. So we are obviously in this instance engaging with planners, engaging with economic development personnel, procurement officials across the wider scope of local authority delivery to ensure that we're not just talking about how to manage waste at the end of its life. How are we building infrastructure to ensure that we're it's not about the end of life, it's about how do we create that circular use of resources both at national level and at a local level to reduce not just the carbon impacts here in Scotland but the global carbon footprint, as we know, goes beyond our measurement of our territorial emissions.
Thanks very much, Ian. And Rosie, if I could put the same question to you. Thank you.
Thank you. And yes, just to say thank you for having us. I know we were accommodated later in the day, so thank you for that. Local authorities, we'd say that they're absolutely vital for the localisation and the translation of the national targets. But they can't do everything on their own, obviously, so the need for that facilitation of partnerships, and particularly with others, with statutory bodies. And maybe a good example there being there's a framework that's been created of partnership and facilitation of the Hagshaw Energy Cluster, and it's maybe a good example of how local authorities are part of planning and seeing that energy development take place, but they're absolutely doing it in partnership with public bodies and with the private sector and with communities. The communities are just as vital as well, and empowering them and enabling the local place planning to come through to delivery is important too.
Thank you, Rosie. And finally, Bruce, same question to you, please.
Thank you. Well, as you may expect, going last in the order, there's a lot of agreement with what everyone else has said, but I think particularly on the biodiversity side of things, there's a strong feeling not only among Scottish Environment Link members that local authorities are under-resourced to be able to carry out what's asked of them within the MPF4, but also just drawing on a little bit of discussion at a recent CIEM event, bringing in local authorities themselves to look specifically at the biodiversity measures within MPF4, and a lot of local authority representatives shared those concerns that there was, there's a lot asked to be able to tackle the nature crisis, and we need to be able to make sure they're resourced appropriately to do it. Rosie's point as well around helping them, maybe not reinventing the wheel everywhere. There's lots of processes around the MPF4 that could be common amongst local authorities, and having a 32 different localised approaches to solving the nature and climate crisis through planning is maybe not the best use of time, or their resources. So I think that is something that we do need to look at within the draft.
Thanks very much, Bruce. There seems agreement, obviously, that local authorities will have a crucial role in delivering net zero targets. I wonder if I could dig a bit deeper into the main challenges faced by local authorities in your experience. In the previous panel, some of the challenges identified were a lack of resource, for example, across planning departments, a lack of the necessary skills and expertise required in delivering some of these really challenging net zero targets, and also financial constraints as a result of budget cuts. I wonder if each of you could give briefly some practical examples of how you see these challenges manifest themselves when you deal with local authorities. And just to mix things up, I'll go in reverse order. So Bruce, I'll come to you first, and then Rosie.
Thank you. Some examples that we can foresee with the kind of burden placed on local authorities would be around, for example, application of positive effects for biodiversity, or what some people refer to as biodiversity net gain. There's a lot of interpretation required there. There's the language around that's not very tight. There could be scope for large developers to really reduce what's expected of them, just simply because local authorities don't have the resource to be able to appropriately assess developments. There's also the kind of follow-up from that. Local authorities, we think, are under-resourced to be able to take a view post the development's implementation, whether it's been successful with meeting positive effects for biodiversity. So that's something that really concerns us. We also see the kind of lack of specific guidance being quite an issue for local authorities. So not only are they having to interpret, they're having to probably look at guidance that's not been drawn up with the climate and nature crisis in mind. We've got some of the documents that are referred to in the document that are a decade old, or some that haven't been written yet. So there's definitely a lot that we're concerned about from the perspective of authorities there, or other planning authorities.
Okay, thanks very much, Bruce. Quite a lot there that we'll follow up on. Rosie, same question to you, please.
Thank you. I'd say that the keeping up up with the pace required on the decision making. We would foresee that demand may only rise, and so that with that is the resourcing question for local authorities. I can't say I feel qualified to answer on around the expertise of local authorities. Certainly when it comes to reviewing applications for planning on their potential harm to nature, to biodiversity, and the carbon emission impacts, there are that gets to the detail of quality of information that's been provided to local authorities to enable them to make decisions. We would foresee not necessarily a problem, but are they receiving the accurate information they need, say on carbon emissions of a future development to weigh up that planning decision? I'll stop there because others.
Okay, Rosie, thank you very much. Ian and then Anna. Ian, I'll bring you in at this stage.
Yeah, thanks. I guess I was just building on what others have said. I mean, clearly, in our experience, it's probably just experience. You know, a lot of the work that we're involved in terms of the circular economy is very new. It's about building new types of infrastructure and new ways of working in terms of partnerships. And going back to our previous point, just about how do you evaluate the kind of proposals that are coming through in terms of carbon. So it is about how do we engage with other parts of local government in terms of awareness raising, provide them with the support so they can gain that expertise and experience in relatively quick time so they can make those types of decisions to progress the projects. But ultimately the support from agencies like ourselves, support from colleagues, also to do things differently. This is ultimately what we're, we could talk about resources, but there are different ways of delivery in terms of, different types of partnerships, both in the private sector and the third sector, to deliver things like reuse and repair infrastructure at a local level. It just needs a different type of thinking. So to some extent, they just need the space and the confidence to go and pursue some of those obvious opportunities in a different way than they've probably been doing before, as well as all the other pressures that they probably have. So possibly a bit more about capacity and within local government.
Okay, thanks very much, Ian. And finally, Anna, same question to you, please.
Yeah, thank you. I guess just to try and add some different elements to points that have been covered, I fully agree about the issues around resourcing, skills, expertise and financial constraints. I think there are also additional areas just around the decision-making cycles. Many of the benefits of investing in a more resilient, climate-resilient future are long-term benefits, where immediate, so it's hard for investments in those benefits to always compete with short-term leads, and that's a constant tension within local authorities. I think the case for change needs to be stronger in terms of the evidence and the economics behind why action on climate resilience is needed. I think there's just really key challenges around mainstreaming. So taking responsibility for climate action outside of the sustainability box and actually embedding that across decision making. So how are we seeing sustainability climate change objectives being delivered through city deal programs, for example? How is that landing with directors of economic development in terms of regional prosperity frameworks? How can we begin to build the economic case for that to translate into some of the major revenue streams that do exist? So I think those are some challenges we need to address within local authorities and their partners.
Okay, great. Well, look, thank you very much for those opening remarks. I'm sure my colleagues will want to explore some of them further. So let me bring in Fiona Hislop.
Thank you and good morning. There has been some criticism that planning policies on biodiversity are too aspirational, and in the preparation of NPF4, one of the working groups looking at securing positive effects for biodiversity, and I want to focus on biodiversity in particular, stated, supportive planning policy on biodiversity and green infrastructure more generally is not translating into delivery on the ground. Green infrastructure can be seen as optional or as an element that can be negotiated out. So now we have the draft NPF4, and I want to come to Bruce Wilson first on this and then to Rosie Simpson. Do you think that the draft NPF4 really delivers on the radical change on biodiversity that the National Spatial Strategy set out in its introduction. So first to Bruce Wilson.
Thanks. Without being too negative, no. Overwhelmingly, the environmental organisations that are represented within Scottish Environment Link think that the high-level rhetoric is really nice about solving the climate and biodiversity crisis holistically, but the actual changes we see from MPF 3 to MPF 4 don't amount to much. There's new sections in there on creating local nature networks and implementing the positive effects for biodiversity. When you actually translate those two things through, it comes down to there's a lot of shoulds and there's not a lot of musts. There is very woolly detail there. We're also very concerned that the approach for kind of a net gain from developments in terms of biodiversity is not kind of data driven. There's no requirement that we can see to establish a baseline. So using the kind of old adage that you can't manage what you don't measure, if we're to somehow assess that a development has had a positive effect for biodiversity, we need to know what's been there in the past. So we're very, very concerned that there's not going to be a data-driven approach to this. We note as well at the international process around COP15, there's requirements being written in for looking at net gain around nature, and that's something we'll presumably be aspiring to when we're creating our new Scottish biodiversity strategy, and the kind of nature targets that have been discussed within the programme for government. We're worried that the national planning framework, which will set the agenda for years to come, won't be coherent with that, and we'll lose a huge opportunity. We know from past experience, if language is woolly around these things, that developers will not put in the required implementation for biodiversity. So just in summary, answering your question, will this provide the transformational change? We don't think it does at all, and we need to see significant strengthening of the language. There's still time to do that. This is a draft document, but we do think that needs to be done.
Thank you. And can I ask the same question to Rosie Simpson?
Yes, so in terms of aspiration, there's and the principles within the draft MPF4, there's an awful lot that we would welcome, and of particular policies 2 and 3 and on natural places, really great and certainly welcome them. But as Bruce said, I suppose when getting to the detail, when thinking about the evidence and to help that way to decision making, and the information that planning bodies are going to need, for example, to know whether the biodiversity will improve overall for development, or whether the carbon savings will be greater than the emissions. That's where whether it can fall into guidance, but that's where I think more detail on the decision points and the thresholds would be really helpful in the draft MPF4. Just to add that land, it is our huge natural carbon store, and it's there as our key for achieving biodiversity targets. So there's nothing in the draft MPF4 that contradicts that, but it's the recognition of that huge potential there that the policies need to follow. And an example of that would be the peatlands, as drafted, that doesn't go far enough on the protections required if we're going to treat that as a natural carbon store in the future.
Thank you. And sticking on this theme and reflecting what you've said about data in particular, I'm very struck that if you've got the same piece of land that is open for development for very positive reasons for renewables, for example, there'll be a very strong, I think, data-driven aspect to carbon reductions using renewable energy. And we've heard about actually what a piece of land may actually end up being double counted for different either companies or organisations. At the same time, we're concerned about the same piece of land, say it's peatland, for example. There's the data is not sufficient, perhaps, to look at some of the issues around the carbon-rich soils, the other aspects, and that biodiversity, therefore, can be the poor relation in relation to that quantification of what impact any development might have. And is there a possibility that MPF4 should enable that interchange? If we've got a twin crisis of biodiversity and climate change, surely if we've got the one piece of land, that actually there needs to be calibration equally between those two crises and measurement of that. And does MPF4 do that, the draft? But if it doesn't, what's needed to make sure it can deliver on both those crises? I'll come first to Rosie and then back to Bruce, and now back to the convener.
So, absolutely. So, a twin crisis here that MPF4 can help us address both at once or go in the opposite direction on biodiversity and climate emergency. Reading the policies, taking them more in the round and not in the isolation, and thinking about how they can work together. I think to be fair to the draft that we have, and that they can. So reading policy 3, say on nature crisis with natural places, and then with say take the green energy policy that's there for 19. But it would be the burden, it definitely would fall on the local authority to continue that very intentional balance with what is there. I don't know, Bruce, if Bruce would like to add to that, but I think there's a lot in the draft that's workable, and we wouldn't say that that twin addressing simultaneously biodiversity and climate can't be reached through it.
Okay, thank you. And if I can come to Bruce, how do you think, therefore, policy 3 and policy 19 could work together in such a way that biodiversity is not seen as the poor relation because it doesn't, for example, have data, etc.?
Well, we're lacking the overarching targets on biodiversity that we have in the same way for climate. So I think that definitely drives policy. And we have got commitment to bring in those targets on biodiversity. So we will hopefully get to a position where policymakers are really driven by the desire to meet those targets. But you know, in the meantime, it's important that we take a data-driven approach. So that should be enshrined. A sort of loose, let's just hope for a kind of overall net gain in there will not bring that balance that we want. And that is a crucial part of the planning policy, is to find that balance between these two developments. I do believe it's possible. I do think there's scope within these documents to have better coherence with things like regional land use partnerships, mm-hmm. which have been brought through the Climate Act and are looking to get communities taking a kind of natural capital based approach to what happens with the land. Finally, I would say as well that historically, even when there have been burdens on developers to put in place biodiversity measures post-development, so you use the wind farm example, there's lots of places where local authorities just don't have the resource to follow up on that and check that these things have been done properly, restoration is going as planned. So there may be a stipulation, but there's not really any way of keeping a check and balance in there. And that is very important that we do make sure that that's been done properly and effectively.
Thank you, and I'll pass back to the convener.
Thank you very much. Fiona, let me bring in Mark Ruskell to be followed by Liam Kerr. Mark.
Yeah, Thanks, Kavina. If I can just stick briefly with biodiversity and national infrastructure, there's a commitment in MPF for local nature networks. I think the understanding is that every local authority will develop its own local nature network. But perhaps if I could start with Bruce and just ask you, what's the difference between that and a national nature network in terms of its status, in terms of planning, and what you're looking for in terms of that status in NPF?
So we think that they're, well, for a start, I'm really glad that they've defined them within the glossary of terms in the NPF 4 document. That's a very positive start. But basically, each local authority has been tasked with having a kind of a range of activities and projects that would constitute a local nature network. That's great, but I think it really gets to the heart of the problem that we're then going to probably have 32 different local approaches to local nature networks with varying degrees of delivery and success between each place, and no real mechanism for joining those up at scale. And we know with biodiversity, if it's bigger, better connected, we get more of those benefits that we need as society, never mind all the kind of intrinsic value that creates, because enhancing our biodiversity. So there was a call from Scottish Wildlife Trust and all the other Link members. It's actually the most signed up to policy document we've ever produced, the Scottish Environment Link, to get this National Ecological Network, or Scottish Nature Network as it's referred to, get that at scale as a national development. We've already talked this morning, you've heard evidence this morning about things like the National Cycle Network, or well, we know the Central Scotland Green Network is in there. So we know we can do these large at scale networks. And it gives, taking that approach would help give a little bit more context to our green and blue infrastructure aspirations. It would maybe help us plan a little bit better where some of these projects go. So there's more ecological coherence and we get a little bit more bang for our buck for investment. We're going to have a problem relatively soon, because we know that public investment in nature is not going to be enough to meet our nature and climate goals. We're going to have to work out how to get private sector funding in there. We're going to have to work out if we have a system of net positive for nature, where that goes in a landscape. A kind of at-scale National Ecological Network or Scottish Nature Network, helping different local authorities map using opportunity mapping the best places for investment and projects on the landscape will help us get a much better handle on this. We would never sort of plan a road network by just having different local authorities put in place different bits of grey infrastructure. Obviously, it's not the same with biodiversity, but we similarly can't expect the same results if we just have different bits of green and blue infrastructure in the landscape. We won't make that coherent network. It's not always have to be a physical network, but just to allow nature to permeate our landscape a little bit better. And that is vital for providing all sorts of services, from flood prevention to pollination for crops, and obviously sequestering carbon. And during lockdown, we're fully aware of the massive benefits of having locally accessible nature as well.
Yeah, I mean, I suppose the point there is you're talking about coordination. So I'm imagining a catchment like the Forth, multiple local authorities, maybe different landscape initiatives, different ecological networks. But does that actually, I mean, I'm trying to get my head around what the actual qualitative difference is of defining that as a national development within MPF4, because, you know, government could turn around and say, well, we'll make sure there's coordination, but we don't really need this as national development. So what does a national development actually kind of bring in the way that, you know, CSGN, for example, has been a national development?
Well, I think that almost answered the question. We've seen the action and the movement within CSGN. There's definable projects that have been taken forward. We've got great initiatives like the Glasgow Clyde Valley Green Network. They're looking at how that blueprint can be applied wider throughout the CSGN. There's a lot more energy and action in that area of Scotland than there are in some other places. Providing that national development angle to it, it becomes a priority. At the moment, there's just a lot of ambition around nature networks that, you know, there's lots of we will strive to create, but there's not actually any defined mechanism for creating the nature network. I think Specifically, what the National Ecological Network could do would be help provide that opportunity mapping, which is so important for us working out where does this green and blue infrastructure go, and to deliver the most benefit for the most Scottish priorities.
Yeah. Okay. I don't know if Rosie wants to come in on this before I move on to a different topic.
Thank you. Just to take up where Bruce left off there on opportunity mapping, I think that's that strategic view and foresight to what areas are we safeguarding or protecting to enable either that connectivity or that ecological restoration, and for that to take place at the same time as we have the planning for say built development for infrastructure, so that we almost don't lose what we have before we know it, in a sense, and critically maybe from the John Muir Trust perspective, we could give the example of the mapped carbon soils that we have as a baseline for a national nature network, and the mapped designated landscapes and wildland areas that we have as a guide really to where we can direct the ecological restoration across Scotland.
Mm-hmm. Okay, thanks. I don't know if Anna has any comments on this specific question at all.
I don't have anything specific. Okay. I think that one of the points that Bruce raised around financing all of this and trying to find a way of like recognising that what we need to do on in terms of nature conservation far exceeds our ability to pay for it at the moment, how we leverage in private sector investment, I think is really crucial in terms of a skills development area. We need more people who can actually come up with innovative financing around nature-based solutions.
Okay.
Nothing in addition
Thanks.
To that.
Thanks, Anna. That's valuable. Can I then move on to a different topic? And I'm going to bring in Ian on this one. You know, waste incineration. I mean, effectively, we've got now a moratorium on decisions on new waste incinerators in Scotland, at least for the length of time that the government is conducting its review into waste incineration, at the very least. So, what do you think is going to come out of the review, Ian, and how do you think that might shape the way that government approaches waste incineration, circular economy in NPF? Will it have any bearing on what's in NPF? And I think there's a related issue here about whether the planning system has actually been effective in the past at ensuring that where waste incinerators have been built, they actually connect in with heat networks and actually deliver on that side of things. I think there's a concern there around loopholes. So do you have thoughts on any of those two points about the effectiveness of the planning system at the moment and what might emerge and how it will relate to NPF going forward?
Yeah, no, thanks, Mark. I'm probably not in a good position to preempt what the review is going to come up with, but obviously we acknowledge that NPF4 does recognise that there is a review, and it says it will take on board any of the outcomes from the review, so obviously that's to be welcomed. So we don't best to talk in too much detail about that. But I think in the past there has been some challenges around energy from waste. In terms of the planning, in terms of the development of proposals, and you're right, we've provided some information about this in terms of the efficiency of some of the existing plants because they've not been attached to heat networks, etc. And there's an opportunity that we're missing. So I think that does need to be, whatever comes out of the review, we need to, strengthen some of that, not just the decision making, but obviously, the implementation of any proposals that come forward. But ultimately, I think we welcome the review within Zero Waste Scotland to understand what the future role is for energy from waste. Ultimately, I said before to this committee, it's the odd thing. We want to get out of waste. So we need to be planning infrastructure in such a way that we can, get ourselves out of waste, whether that's for incineration or landfill. Ultimately, we want to move things up the hierarchy and reduce waste and obviously create that circular economy. And it just feels odd that we're, for us, there's some good stuff. A lot to be commended in the National Planning Framework 4 around waste, but it really misses the point about circular economy. It doesn't. A lot of the language in it still feels very linear about how do we manage disposal going forward is if it's always going to be there, it's always going to be something that we're going to have to deal with, other than, you know, trying to create a different economy in terms of the materials and the use of that. So I think there are, again, there's some of the specifics, there's some of the language is still very linear for us. And we need to be looking much broadly at how do we embed circular economy, not just in the waste chapter or the waste policy 20, but, you know, in lots of the other policy areas as well. How we just talked about green energy, but about might move on to local living and 20-minute neighbourhoods. You know, there's a huge opportunity to shift the thinking around infrastructure. That it's not just about the linear economy and what do we do with the waste once it's been produced. How do we drive infrastructure, or how do we create infrastructure, the right infrastructure, accessible infrastructure for all citizens, communities, and businesses to participate further up the hierarchy?
Yeah, I think other colleagues might want to come in on certain aspects of that, but can I just put that question around waste incineration, where it sits with NPF, what may change to Bruce or Environment Link?
Sorry, I had a little dropout there. Can everyone hear me?
Yeah. Did you get the original question that I posed?
Yeah, sorry, I heard it there. It was just a blip on the screen, sorry. Yes, I mean, I think what Ian says around needing a bit more clarity is probably where we come from that as well. There's certainly, we recognise as well what Ian's saying about the kind of embedding of the issue there with regards to waste. But yeah, I think there's broadly an agreement with Ian.
Okay, back to you, Camille.
Great, thank you very much, Mark. Next up, Liam Kerr. Liam, over to you, please.
Thank you, Convener. I will direct a question to Anna Besic, please, on coastal protection and resilience, and then if any other panel members wish to come in on either of these questions, just indicate. Anna, good morning. The Policy 35 requires that the local development plan spatial strategy should consider how to adapt coastlines to the impact of climate change, and says there is a need for a proactive and innovative approach. In your view, how well does NPF 4 support the need for climate adaptation and coastal resilience, and how proactive does it really require stakeholders to be?
Great, thanks for that question. I think, I guess to answer your last question first around how proactive does coastal resilience require stakeholders to be, it requires them to be extremely proactive. There are very serious risks facing areas of Scotland's soft, low-lying coasts. We're facing very significant changes in terms of sea level rise and coastal erosion risk, and it's definitely not a challenge that can be left for another day. I think there were some really good signals within NPF4 around the need for coastal adaptation. I'd like to see more around what we would call flexible adaptation pathways, and that means where we understand the kind of near-term current risks that we face, we build resilience to those, but we're also much more aware of the long-term risks, and we use a flexible approach to planning that will allow us to respond as risks emerge in future. And I don't think there's currently enough about the need for that kind of adaptation pathways, that flexible approach built into NPF4 at the moment. So I'd like to see more of that. It connects in with nature-based solutions as well. We have excellent assessment of coastal climate change risk through the Dynamic Coast project in Scotland, which tells us about the extent to which nature and natural coastal systems is protecting key assets and land in Scotland. So understanding how we sustain and value those assets is crucial as well. We're working across Scotland through the Adaptation Scotland programme in urban, rural and island communities, and the approaches to addressing coastal risks need to be different in those places, depending on whether they have existing built defences like we have in Edinburgh, which gives you a false sense of security. You've got those defences, you just assume those will always exist, you'll make them a bit higher, but actually the kind of changes we're seeing are game-changing around the kind of risk exposure that we face in future and the way in which we need to be considering coastal climate risk, in my view, and that's It's even more evident in low-lying island communities that face very present and real risks that are not currently being addressed in the way they need to be.
I'm very grateful for the answer, and I think that last point might be the key one. What I have in my mind is the issue that's going on at Montrose in my region, that I've been very active with colleagues from across the parties in trying to address. And that leads on to, on a similar point, that various members of the panel throughout the morning have talked about the current burdens on local authorities. And that is happening in a context of, as Bruce Wilson pointed out earlier on, major budget cuts and funding pressures. So, in your view, given what you've just said about the need to proactively address this, is NPF4 sufficiently cognizant of the ability of local governments, financially and resource-wise, to mitigate what we're seeing happening at Montrose and the likes? Or does it need to be stronger in mandating central government to provide the resources and the financing, do you think?
Yeah, it's a great question about the resourcing implications. I think there are, like, areas like Montrose are kind of the forerunners almost, where we're seeing these climate risks very imminently, and you're seeing those impacts, and they are kind of a shadow of things to come. So what's playing out in Montrose, if we haven't had the benefit of time,
No, go ahead. Carry on.
Oh, sorry. I just wondered if you could hear me. Yeah, so I guess, I think, yeah, there does need to be much more recognition of the scale of this challenge and much more resourcing coming into it, both nationally and locally. I think there's some excellent expertise in Scotland. There's some excellent partnership work happening, some really good evidence coming to the fore that's telling us more about coastal climate change risks. Some positive work has really started, but I think, unfortunately, the scale of the challenge that we face means that additional resourcing is an essential part of what needs to happen, and that to see that strengthened in NPF4 would be excellent.
That's very helpful. I'm very grateful for the answer. I believe other panel members wish to come in. But I'm not sure who, so make yourself known.
Perhaps not, Liam.
All right. In that case, I'll hand back to you, convener.
Great, Liam. Thank you very much. Next up is Natalie Dawn, to be followed by Monica Lennon. Natalie, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener, and good morning, panel. Yeah, I would like to focus on woodlands and ask the panel, is the wording on Policy 34 on trees, forests and woodlands sufficiently clear and directive to guide development in a way that is sensitive to existing woodlands? And do you have any examples of additional public benefits in Policy 34C that would justify the removal of woodlands? And if I could come first to Anne, please. Thank you.
Thanks for that question.
Anna.
Oh, no problem, no worries. Sorry. Just one small letter missing. Just around the role of woodlands, I think one thing that is I'd like to see acknowledged through that kind of policy, and but just more broadly across the natural environment content of NPF4 is just the state of the climate emergency that we're facing around existing risks to the natural environment, including woodland species. So the latest UK climate change risk assessment was published last summer, which highlights that risks to the natural environment, including to pests and diseases and to woodlands, are increasing, have increased over the last 5 years, and are an area that requires further action, so that we need to be considering that when we're considering the role of woodlands as part of the kind of progress towards net zero in terms of their ability to provide those vital ecosystem services. Unless we protect woodlands, unless we enhance the health of woodlands, unless we focus on reducing risks from pests and diseases, they won't be able to retain their current services, let alone deliver the enhancements that we need if we're to meet net zero. And I'd like to see that kind of messaging strengthened a little bit more personally. But yeah.
Thanks for those comments, Anna. Can I come next to Bruce, please?
Yeah. So actually, the policy around ancient woodlands and veteran trees and stuff, we really welcome. It's nice to be positive about aspects of the document, since I was kind of slightly more negative about some of the early stuff. So yeah, we really welcome that, and we really want to see that carried through into the final document. If we could, in policy 34, strengthen that slightly to say the development proposals must not be supported where they would result in any loss of ancient woodland, ancient trees or veteran trees, or adverse impacts to their ecological condition. That I think that would actually be great by Scottish Environment Link's view of the document. There's so many benefits that these trees bring in both kind of urban environments, but also in rural environments as well. There's all sorts of information available on the kind of financial benefits that they bring in terms of flood prevention, slowing the flow of water, sequestering carbon, reducing urban heat island effects and everything. But let's also just think about the huge cultural aspect of these trees within communities. You know, how much seeing those trees out and about in green space can really help make you feel better, and really kind of tie a sense of identity to development as well. So it's a huge welcome step, I think, that improvement in the policy around woodlands policy 34, isn't it? Yeah.
So obviously, sorry, can I just follow up on that? In terms of the additional public benefits that we're seeing in policy 34C, are you saying that you would rather just see it strengthened so that woodland is protected over, not over the public benefits, but you find that the most important thing?
Yes. I mean, there's the number of public benefits that these woodlands provide, there will be occasional exceptions to that, but overwhelmingly they provide massive benefit in terms of everything I just listed as well. But there's also the mental health aspects as well of trees are very important.
Sorry, I'm not sure if I've sort of came across right there. So obviously, it's saying the additional public benefits that would justify the removal of woodland. So I'm just saying that you would like to see it strengthened so that the removal of woodland would not be possible, or would be an absolute last option.
Yes, thanks for the clarification. Yeah, sorry. Okay. I didn't...
Thank you. No problem at all. I'll come to Ian last if you've got anything to add, Ian.
Not really, not specifically about ancient woodlands. I mean, it still comes back to, you know, even the biodiversity point for me. You know, we need to remind ourselves that, you know, the extraction of virgin raw materials globally contribute 90% of all biodiversity and water stress globally comes from our continuing extraction of materials. So all of the stuff that's on the plan around NPF4, around, you know, reducing the impact of materials on our built environment going forward, making more of the buildings and infrastructure that we already have, making it more flexible so we're not building things new, is clearly going to have a huge, if we stick to that, you know, and make that paramount to our plans going forward, then, you know, the stress, the pressure on our own environment, biodiversity loss, and woodlands, etc., is going to be greatly enhanced, you know, as well as globally as well. So, yeah, all of that is interlinked. And I think we need to look at it that way, you know, how important some of those other policies that are listed are, you know, take the pressure off what we've just been talking about. It's critical both at a national level and at a local level.
Thanks, all. I have no further questions on that. I'll pass back to the convener. Thanks.
Thanks very much, Natalie. Next up is Monica Lennon, to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Monica, over to you, please.
Thank you, convener. Just before I go into my question, I think I heard Mark Ruskell refer to a moratorium on new incinerators. My understanding is that ministers haven't confirmed a moratorium, but have asked planning authorities to notify them of any new applications and decisions for energy for waste development. So perhaps we can get clarification on that later for the official report. But I think it's good that we are discussing the role of incineration and energy for waste in the waste hierarchy, because from 2011 until 2020, the total quantity of waste that was incinerated in Scotland has increased by over 200%. So it clearly is an issue worth exploring today. So turning to the question then, if we don't see a permanent ban or moratorium on new energy from waste developments, what should we see in national planning framework four in relation to the future role, bearing in mind possible climate and nature impacts? I think already heard from Ian Gullen today that NPF4 is missing the point on circular economy. So there is a bigger picture here, but I'd just be interested to hear views from the panel, perhaps coming to Ian first, since I've mentioned you, Ian.
I mean, I guess my answer still is it's probably too early for me to make comment on, you know, the review, and, you know, which will hopefully bring a bit of clarity to the future role of incineration of Scotland, and therefore, you know, NPF4 would hopefully take recognition of that. We just something I meant to briefly mention. I mean, there is things in there around, you know, maximising the opportunities for, say, heat from any energy from waste facilities that are built. I mean, it doesn't actually have a position statement on proposed incinerators without energy recovery. So whether they're going to be allowed or not, doesn't, you know, you could say it could be more explicit on that if we were going to have such infrastructure going forward. There's also, yeah, even linking up with, you know, local heat strategies, heat and energy efficiency strategies, in terms of the energy efficiency programme. So just recognising that, you know, there are other things that could be taken into account if, you know, future proposals for energy from waste were coming forward. But again, we're yet to see what the review comes out with. But again, I think there's lots to commend in this NPF4 around circular economy. It says lots of really good things around, you know, embodied carbon and buildings and infrastructure, you know, thinking about different materials, recycled materials and other infrastructure, making the best use of what we've already got, refurbishment, designing for deconstruction, you know, the flexible use, which is hugely important. I just saw the end of the last panel when we're talking about, you know, 20-minute neighbourhoods, you know, adaptability going forward. Goes back to Anna's point around, you know, the challenges that we have in terms of adaptation, because climate change is already happening. You know, how flexible can we make our buildings going forward? So there's lots of good phrases and proposals there, but then it just gets into the kind of waste point. You know, I guess I think it just misses that point. You know, the waste section is very much about the linear economy and what do we do with the waste, whereas, you know, how can we design infrastructure, how can we develop infrastructure that's around reuse, repair, refurbishment, you know, and it's not about big facilities. You know, the circular economy is a much more distributive economy, you know, across the whole of Scotland. It's not about sucking materials out of all of the Scotland into some big factories in the central belt of Scotland. Whether that's incinerators or not, it's about distributive materials and products in local communities, particularly in the Highlands and Islands, where we can really see economic regeneration, social regeneration, you know, preventing loss of jobs, etc. You know, there's a real opportunity here, and I just think that's missed, you know, in terms of how we could embed circular economy thinking and planning for some of that other infrastructure that's talked about throughout. And obviously linking into the protection of our natural species.
Thank you, Ian. I think Rosie wants to respond next.
Thank you. My request to come in was it was on the woodlands policy, so I'm happy to stay quiet on that if the moment has gone. I can give a contribution. Yeah.
If you want to add anything, Rosie, please go ahead.
Okay. Apologies then, just for taking us back to the woodlands policy, but at the time of that conversation, I could reiterate and echo what others said, but in addition, I thought it would be that that policy could ask more from developers and it's on the enhancement of the biodiversity. So whereas the policies are drafted are clear on the need to protect ancient woodlands and native woodlands and veteran trees, there's that step on, which is about, I suppose, the enhancement and what can we or planning authorities be asking of developers in terms of bringing forward plans for how they will be enhancing woodland creation, which has huge biodiversity benefits. That was all. Thank you for allowing me to come in.
No, thanks, Rosie. I'm glad you got your point on the record. I wonder if I can perhaps ask Bruce for a Scottish Environment Link perspective on the climate and nature impacts of incinerators or large-scale energy from waste developments, and just these points about clarity and how NPF4 aligns with other reviews. Does SELink have a view on this, Bruce?
Yeah, so again, sorry, just kind of echoing quite a lot of what Ian said, to be honest. I mean, if there is energy from waste facilities, there definitely should be a requirement to make use of that, the heat that's being produced. But I think we kind of question the place for energy from waste beyond anything, beyond the sort of medium term, really, because, you would really hope we'd have got to a grips with a circular economy. By its very definition, creating energy from your waste, you're not continuing that cycle circularity. So yeah, I mean that's where we are there. And there's obviously a lot of issues around particulates and other things created from the incineration process. That would be of concern to us as well. So we would probably question in a kind of net zero and with a circular economy in place, whether there's a real place for energy from waste in Scotland. Does that?
Thank you. That's really helpful, Bruce. And finally, Anna, do you have a take on this?
I would just endorse Ian's points around the kind of the need to consider the circular economy as the main focus for NPF4 and thinking about the system-wide changes required to deal with our waste in a more sustainable way seems to me like, yeah, I would defer to Ian's judgment if he feels that that's not fully communicated through NPF4. It would be good to see that strengthened.
Okay, just while we're chatting here, I'm just thinking we don't yet have the Circular Economy Bill or that legislation in place. So does anyone have a view on the importance of that legislation coming forward so that everyone involved in making planning decisions knows that this is something that's really important? Ian's popped up on my screen, so...
Yeah. No, it wasn't on that. I wanted to give an example of something I was talking about, maybe just slightly missing the point, if I could use that phrase, because there's a bizarre statement in policy 20, I think it's towards the end, it talks about, look at my notes, talks about development proposals will not be allowed if they directly or indirectly limit the operation of existing or proposed waste management facilities. I mean, that just, you kind of think, but surely the circular economy is all about limiting, the disposal of waste. So you kind of think, how does that work if we're all serious about proposals for reuse, repair, remanufacturing, repurposing of materials? Then are they going to be stopped because they start to compete with existing infrastructure? I mean, it's a little bit about the language. I think we're just it feels that we're that section is very much looking backwards, and I think we could be a bit more creative in what we're trying to do here. Sorry, your point was about, I think the circular economy was hugely important, thinking about that, how that could help frame, the direction of travel going forward, absolutely. Also, there's references there to government strategies. I mean, clearly we have targets at the moment, 2025, but we're obviously working with government on developing a route map beyond 2025 as well to hit the targets 2025 and beyond. So just references there that, things are moving, it's a very dynamic space. So it's not, NPF4 is hopeful for a 10-year window, so just trying to make sure that we're playing in all these other things that are happening as well.
Thank you, Ian, and I'm glad you mentioned policy 20 in NPF4 because I'm looking at part of it that these development proposals for energy from waste should only be supported
where it is consistent with climate change mitigation targets and in line with circular economy principles, and should supply a decarbonisation strategy aligned with Scottish Government decarbonisation goals and be refused where the strategy is insufficient. I mean, I'm a former town planner and I find all that a little bit difficult to navigate. And we've heard about the shortage of planners, issues around skills. So again, you've mentioned part of Policy 20, I've read it another part. Do we think that we're creating some mixed messages here?
Yeah. Sorry if you're asking me. I think it's just a bit of clarity about how the circular economy fits in, or to the broader, you know, planning, obviously, rather than just on waste. I think that's important, you know. But I agree, and I think, you know, goes back to my earlier point about local authority planning officers or developers. You know, how do you navigate through that in terms of, you know, what you're evaluating specific projects against? You know, just because there's quite a lot in that list that you've just read out, you know, and there'll be other things, you know, when you add in, you know, communities and social justice and all sorts of other economic development, job, all of the other things that are taken into consideration as well, and obviously, you know, mitigations. So, it's always about the delivery, isn't it? You know, these are, you know, high-level documents, strategies, setting, you know, certain principles, but what guidance is going to be made available to, as you say, local authority planners to navigate through proposals. But it's not about, you know, some of this I still think is reactive. It's what comes forward. You know, it comes back to an earlier point I think Anna made around, you know, funding of this. If we're going to be much more strategic and thinking about what infrastructure we need, there needs to be some sort of investment strategy that sits alongside that, whether that's public funded or public private funded, you know, that people can start to understand how do we make these things happen rather than just wait for people to come up with proposals and then try and understand whether it fits or not. You know, we know the kind of things that we need to do, you know, certainly we do in terms of the circular economy, the infrastructure that people are beginning to think about, how we can shape that. We need to do that nationally. We need to go back to your thing about national, what do you call it, national natural parks. You know, you have a national one or you have local ones. We need to make it all joined up, but we need to make the provisions for reuse, repair, refurbishment, redevelopment of opportunities across the whole of Scotland. It's not just, can't just do it, you know, here's an authority doing something but nobody else is doing it here. We need to have a much more common approach that's strategic, and it comes back to a point I made last week to another committee around, so local authorities absolutely have a vital role, but they also have a vital role to work together to bring that coherence, that coordination across Scotland to our national picture, particularly around resources. So it's not, yeah, absolutely they're vital to what they do in their own communities, but they're vital how they can work together and really make the impact by working together.
That's really helpful. Thank you for that, Ian. I don't have any more questions. Does anyone else in the panel want to add anything before I hand back to the convener? I can't see anyone, so that's why I'm asking.
Don't think there is,
no.
Monica.
Okay,
no.
Back to you, convener.
Thank you very much, Monica. Last up, final question from Jackie Dunbar. Jackie, over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, convener. It's to ask the panel a couple of probably different questions, if you don't mind. I think it's fair to say that everybody believes that there are a greenfield site should not be used if at all possible, and we should be using brownfield sites whenever we can. So can I ask the panel how could MPF4 policies on the vacant and derelict land be strengthened to reduce the pressure on our greenfield sites? Can I maybe ask Anna and maybe Bruce?
Sure, thank you. Thanks for that question. I think it's a really important challenge. I wonder how much this connects to the place principle and about the involvement of communities in decisions about land that you know, that land that's a part of their community, often with like post-industrial legacy, and coming up with creative solutions and multiple use for brownfield sites in ways that perhaps haven't been done previously. I wonder if there's more that could be introduced there to, as we consider about how to make the most of these assets. So that's something that springs to mind for me. Pause there.
Thank you. And Bruce, do you have anything to you would like to add?
Yeah, thanks very much. Quite often, because access to high quality biodiverse green space is so limited in our urban areas, that we find that brownfield sites can sometimes become real biodiversity hotspots. Locally, I can provide further information to the committee on that if that's of interest. But basically, you can find some really rare plants and species. But we also know, just from being around these spaces ourselves, that they become become popular walking places. There's little informal path networks formed. So absolutely, we see the sense in that kind of preference away from greenfield sites. But there we do have to keep in mind slightly the local importance of those sites to both wildlife and people. I think it would be nice to put a kind of a line in Policy 31 around that, around something like, where the return to a naturalised state isn't likely or something, to make sure that we're getting that balance that was mentioned previously by the committee member between the kind of carbon importance and the biodiversity importance.
Okay, thank you. I'm not sure if Rosie or Ian would like to come in. I can't see, convener. If not, I'm more than happy to go on to my next question.
That's fine, Jackie.
Okay, sorry, I'm not getting used to being online when we're having a meeting like this. The climate change adaptation policies in the MPEF4 places emphasis on the flood risk and the application of nature-based solutions. Now, I know from where I live, we've got a couple of sud systems round about me, and they are totally different from one another. So can I ask the panel, how well is Scotland currently doing in terms of the uptake of SUDs, or sustainable urban drainage systems? And do you think there should be standards and best practices that must be applied to ensure that these deliver maximum benefits? I think I would probably go to Bruce again, maybe first.
Thanks. I think at the moment the qualifier that's used around SUDs ponds is they should be put in place wherever practicable, and we'd like to see that strengthened to a kind of an absolute, really. They're very important. You also mentioned sustainable urban drainage as a kind of nature-based solution. I'd suggest that the MPF4 picked up nature-based solutions and used that in the glossary of terms. It's used a lot in the document, but it's really important we define that properly. The IUCN, the International Union for the Conservation of Nature, define nature-based solutions very well, and it'd be very easy for the Scottish Government to pick up that and use it. But sorry, just back to SUDs. The use of SUDs, especially biodiverse SUDs, so we're providing not only the flood mitigation benefit, but also the biodiversity benefit, is essential from Scottish Environment Link's point of view. And as I say, that strengthening around the language would be welcome.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. As I said, I've got two totally different ones, just 2-minute walk from where I live, and the nature biodiversity one is just absolutely brilliant with all the wildflowers and everything that comes out of it. Sorry, I'm digressing a little bit. I wonder if, Rosie, do you have anything to add on this one, or will I just go to Anna?
Thank you. No, I don't have anything to add to what Bruce has said.
You can see my
screen. Sorry, Anna.
So, great. Thank you. Thanks for that. I think you're just hearing you talk about your experience of walking past the beautiful SUDS pond that gave so many more benefits, really could really see that, just the power of that kind of really how when they're well designed and well planned, that kind of blue green infrastructure can deliver so many additional benefits, and that's so much added value for people. And I think the ambition for that is really strong within the current draft of MPF4. Perhaps examples such as the one you provided really bring that to life, as in what that actually means in practice. So there's a lot of talk about nature-based solutions, about blue-green infrastructure, But I think what you've described there and your personal experience is what that actually can mean for people in practice. And so I think anything that we can do to really strengthen the multiple benefits and see that actually the challenges that we face because of the impacts of climate change in terms of increased flood risk, our responses to those can deliver many benefits for society. Yes, we need to reduce flood risk, but we can do that in such a way that it improves quality of the natural environment, it improves quality of life, access to open spaces for people. So I think it's really important. I think if I may just pick up on one point, I think you were quite right in emphasising that the current MPF4 just naturally flood risk is a key risk for Scotland. And we've talked about coastal risk and flood risk this morning, which has been really important. I think I would just like to highlight in terms of the national developments that are put forward within MPF4. I feel that there's a lack of connection at the moment between the kind of low carbon net zero ambition within the national developments and what's required in terms of climate resilience. And I think that needs to be strengthened because otherwise there's a risk of stranded assets in future if our net zero investments are not fit for a future climate. I think the policy statements of MPF4 make that intention, but it's not translated into the national the national priorities at the moment in quite as the way that I would like to see. So just to, I guess, segue a little bit and make that point in case it's helpful.
Okay, thank you very much. Back over to you, convener, because I have no further questions.
That's great, Jackie. Thank you very much. And that brings us to the end of our allocated time and the end of our questions. So let me thank the panel once again for joining us this morning. Your contributions have been very much welcomed, and we appreciate you taking time to join the committee session. The committee will share its findings with the lead committee on NPF4 at the end of this month, and this concludes our evidence sessions on NPF4. I will suspend this meeting briefly to allow a change of witness and to get ready to hear from the Minister for Transport. Thank you very much. Minister's here.
I'll keep mine to one.
Okay, so Fiona, you've got one, yeah. Mark.
Whatever you say, I can pass it on. What's up? Can you get me 1.5?
1.5, okay, that's good. We're doing decimals, are we? We're doing fractions. Liam, I've got your WhatsApp message.
And Monica has a question. See what she says.
Okay. Yes. Yeah. I'll make mention of that. Are we waiting for the minister? Okay. Are we good to go? Okay. Welcome back, everyone, to our last public agenda item of the day, which is evidence session on Scottish Statutory Instrument 2022-4, the Workplace Parking Licensing Scotland Regulations 2022. These regulations are subject to the negative procedure. This means they will become law unless within 40 days a motion to annul has been laid before Parliament. If a motion to annul is laid, the instrument must be debated by the lead committee, which is this committee. This instrument helps pave the way for workplace parking licensing and sets out a number of practical considerations and issues. So it's important that we have an evidence session with the Minister and officials before we formally dispose of the instrument at our next meeting. I therefore welcome Jenny Gilruth, MSP, Minister for Transport. I also welcome officials who are joining us remotely, Heather Cowan, Elizabeth Hawley and Sandy McNeill. Thank you, Minister and officials, for making yourself available for this session. I also welcome you to your new ministerial role, and the committee also passes on its best wishes to your predecessor, Graeme Day, MSP. The committee is joined for this session by Graeme Simpson, MSP, who is joining us for consideration of this instrument. Minister, I believe you would want to make a short opening statement, so I will pass over to you. Thank you.
Convener, thank you for inviting me today to provide evidence on the Workplace Parking Licensing Scotland Regulations 2022. As you're aware, the power for local authorities to set up workplace parking licensing schemes was included in the Transport Scotland Act 2019, and further regulations and guidance are necessary in order for local authorities to implement these schemes. In line with the commitment made in our climate change plan update, the National Transport Strategy Delivery Plan and the Scottish Budget for 22-23, these regulations were laid in Parliament last month. The regulations will be followed by guidance for local authorities in the first half of 2022. The purpose of these regulations is to make detailed and technical provision on certain elements of the framework already provided by the Transport Act, so that local authorities can use that tool that Parliament has provided them to implement workplace parking licensing schemes that suit their local circumstances. These provisions will help ensure that schemes operate effectively and fairly. As the previous Rural Economy and Connectivity Committee heard, having held an evidence session on workplace parking licensing at stage two consideration of the Bill for the Transport Act back in 2019, workplace parking licensing schemes have the potential to encourage the use of more sustainable travel while raising revenue that will be used to improve public and sustainable transport. It also supports our commitment to reduce car kilometres travelled by 20% by 2030 as part of our climate change goals. These new discretionary local powers, which are already held by councils in England and Wales, were welcomed by our local authority partners in COSLA and by local leaders of all parties. It supports this government's aim to put more say over local resources in local hands, an ambition which has been supported by leaders across political parties too. I'm pleased that these regulations have been laid so that local authorities can use their new powers if they choose to do so. And my officials and I will be happy to answer any questions from the committee on the content of the regulations and the framework that they provide for local authorities.
Thank you very much, Minister. We'll now move to questions, and I'd appreciate, there's quite a few members who have questions, I'd appreciate brief responses if at all possible. My question relates to concerns raised that the regulations could be highly regressive in their impact. Can I ask the Minister what assessment has been made to ensure the parking levy will not disproportionately impact those on lower pay who might not be able to afford it, making parking at work the preserve of those on higher salaries who can afford the additional expense?
Thank you for your question, Convener. I think it's important to reflect that there were assessments considered the impact arising from the regulations, and decisions which were considered and made by Parliament in the Transport Act, of course, were out with the scope of the impact assessments themselves, as those were decisions which would be for local authorities. But you mentioned a point regarding potentially an inequality that this might create. And I know from my own constituency, my own experience locally, that poor areas, for example, have low levels of car ownership. So we know there's already a challenge there in terms of facilitating behavioural change. But we also know that car ownership is more likely to occur in richer areas of society. So it's hugely important that local authorities think carefully about the introduction of the scheme itself. And of course, it is up to local authorities to make prescription for the scheme locally, and to take into consideration, I think, some of the key issues you raised with regard to inequality and how that might impact upon staff members locally.
Let me bring in Fiona Hislop.
Thank you. Can you confirm the discretionary nature of this, and that two or more local authorities can choose to jointly implement a licensing scheme for workplace parking, bearing in mind, for example, a number of political parties previously have advocated this for the City of Edinburgh, but a lot of the commuters don't come from Edinburgh, they come from, for example, my constituency in West Lothian. What options are there for the spend from the levy to be coordinated between two local authorities?
I thank Fiona Hislop for her question, specifically with regard to her first question, which links to the discretionary nature of the legislation. This is, of course, the discretionary power for local authorities. So it will be for the local authority to decide whether they wish to use that power and to shape proposals which will suit local circumstances. Local authorities will be required to undertake a public consultation and impact assessment before implementing a WPL scheme, which I think is really important and links back to the convener's point around about inequity and how that might be tackled locally. They may also use revenues from WPL to support the policies in their local transport strategy, which additionally is hugely important in terms of the revenue that this scheme will generate. To the specific point, though, with regard to whether or not the scheme can be accessed across more than one local authority, the member is correct. That is the case, and that is inbuilt into the legislation currently.
Okay. Thank you, Fiona. Liam Kerr to be followed by Mark Ruskell, please.
Thank you, Convener. Minister, the instrument makes provision for schemes to be examined by a reporter, but only if the Council chooses, and it will be for the Council to choose the scope of that examination. The reporter then goes on and decides the process and the timetable. Now, some might feel that that's the Council rather marking its own homework. So, under what circumstances would a Council be expected to do this? How often, i.e., is the default position that there would be a reporter? And what issues would the reporter consider when deciding the procedure to be followed at a public examination?
I thank Liam Kerr for his question. So on the specifics with regard to the scope or nature, in our guidance for local authorities, we will outline the themes that have emerged from the public consultation, which was undertaken to inform the regulations and guidance. So this will include issues that were out with the scope of the regulations, but that local authorities might want to look at, given their own consultations and the needs of their own local communities. That guidance will also include referencing to the support already available to local authorities in existing guidance for best practice on consultation. And just to the timescales around about that, which I appreciate Mr Kerr might have an interest in that, I checked with officials this morning and we do plan to publish guidance in the first half of 2022. And I'd be happy to share more details with the committee on that specific point, because I appreciate it has been raised in previous evidence session, I think, with the Historic Committee.
Thank you, Minister. And yes, I think that would be useful. You correctly anticipated my question. Following on from that, can you tell me what consideration has the Scottish Government given to if a workplace is nowhere near public transport, or, for example, if shift workers can't get home by public transport after a certain time? And on a related note, what impact does the Scottish Government project such schemes would have on surrounding streets?
I thank Mr Kerr for his question. Apologies, Convener. He asked an additional point in his last question regarding the role of the reporter. So if I may come back on that specifically, it would be for the reporter to determine the process for examination based on the requirements that are set out in the Act, and to look at the options available to the reporter for the examination on the basis of whether or not the reporter needed further information. So it wouldn't be for me, for example, to direct the reporter in that respect. And that is in line with the regulations on examination elsewhere, for example, around about low emission zones. Now, Mr Kerr's additional question links to access in terms of public transport links locally and potential challenges that might exist in areas where that's not apparent. That would have to be a decision for the local authority to consider. It wouldn't be for ministers to instruct, but I think he raises a fair concern. And of course, there is a requirement built into the regulations which requires local authorities to consult locally before bringing in any new schemes. So I think that that would address Mr Kerr's point. I don't know if officials want to come in on further specifics with regard to the regulations on the historic consultation that was undertaken.
Minister, it's Heather Cowan. I was just going to come in to additionally to say inbuilt within the Act is also the requirement that the revenues arising from workplace parking levies cover, of course, the net cost, but are also then available to support delivery of a local authority's national transport strategy. So that might, for example, provide scope to support public transport within a local authority's area.
Thank you. I have one final question, Minister, and it's around measurement. The stated aims of the policy, which you alluded to earlier, include reducing car use and increasing the use of public transport. How does the Scottish Government intend to formally measure to establish whether the implementation of a workplace parking levy has caused the achievement of the aims? In other words, that there is causation rather than simply correlation. And on the same measurement point, how does the Scottish Government intend to measure the convener's point on whether if employers pass the cost on to employees that we're not simply forcing the lower paid members of a company, say, onto public transport while the higher paid members avail themselves of the parking space?
I think to Mr Kerr's specific point on the measurement, this is a scheme that will be administered at local level. So given that local discretion is built into the scheme, we will expect local authorities to take it forward on condition of the local circumstances in front of them. There won't be a statutory application of the scheme, I don't think, nationwide, for example. And this HISLOC, for example, gave the idea of local authorities working together, which I think makes sense, particularly when there are blurred boundaries and people commute across local authority boundaries, as it were. On the specifics with regard to measurement, this is really a matter for local authorities to measure the impact in their local area. And as to the aims that he sets out in terms of a reduction in car kilometres, we absolutely expect that this legislation will drive behavioural change. And he knows the importance of facilitating that modal change, moving away from cars and onto public transport. He links again back to the convener's point around about potential challenge in terms of inequity. This was considered, I think, previously with regard to how poorer, I suppose, employees might fail in terms of how they might not be able to afford the expense this would incur upon them. I think it is important that this is about local authorities, though, taking local decisions and then employers deciding whether or not they want to pass that charge on. So this links back to how a local authority, for example, might carry out its own consultation locally to look at the needs of employees. And I very much hope and would expect that local employers and local authorities would consider the financial incumbents on this, on the earnings, for example, of their employees, which I think is hugely important. We don't want to make this a prohibitive measure at all. But then the second part of Mr Kerr's question is actually, how do you make public transport more affordable? And I think there are a number of mechanisms we're already undertaking in this space. So last week, for example, we had the launch of the under 22s free travel bus travel scheme. And we also have the Fair Fares Review, which allows us to look at how public transport joins up, but equally how that funding is applied and charges are applied equitably or not, as may be the case across the country. So I think that's a hugely important challenge as we move forward. But it's not a reason not to move to this scheme. And I hope Mr Kerr will understand my views and my reasoning behind that.
No further questions, Convener.
Thanks very much, Liam. Mark Ruskell to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Yeah, thanks. I mean, obviously, where workplace parking levies have been introduced, they've raised millions and millions of pounds for public transport, active travel investment. But is there a requirement on councils to invest in those types of priorities? Because I think the measure sort of points to local transport strategies, which could, of course, be, you know, broader in terms of the investment priorities than just investment in active travel and public transport. So is there reassurance here that we can get that the monies raised will be invested in the solutions that people need to get them out of cars in the first place?
Yeah. I thank Mr. Ruskell for his question. So he's right to say that any revenue raised by the workplace parking levy must be used to support local transport strategies that can support greener transport choices and affordable public transport. Now, in Nottingham, which Mr. Ruskell has mentioned, it has, of course, its own WPL scheme since, I think, 2012, and the city has amongst the highest public transport use in the UK, with an associated decrease of 40 million car miles over the last 15 years alone. But the revenue from WPL has also supported the expansion of Nottingham's successful tram system and the redevelopment and capacity enhancement of Nottingham train station, along with investment in bus services and electric buses. Nottingham council officials have also said that these schemes just wouldn't have happened without the working place car place levy, and they've also made grants available to support employers to put in place sustainable transport measures like bike parking, showers, electric vehicle charge points and car park management systems, for example. So to his question, yes, there is a requirement that this would be reinvested locally. And I think it speaks to the importance of local discretion for local authorities deciding on what their transport strategies and priorities are and using this funding to support it accordingly.
Yeah, so you would expect then that in any public consultation on introduction of workplace parking levy, there'd be a consultation with the public as well about what their priorities are, so that we're able to see that there are alternatives coming down the tracks, and you know, not going to be lumped with paying for charges forever because there's going to be investment in those alternatives.
Absolutely. There is a requirement for local authorities to consult locally with the people that they represent ultimately. So it's imperative that the people who live locally have an opportunity to feed into what this looks like and how they experience the strategy. So yes, to the specific point.
Yeah, thanks.
Thanks very much, Mark. Monica Lennon to be followed by Jackie Dunbar. Monica, please.
Thank you, Convener, and good afternoon, Minister. Congratulations on your new role. Thinking about the licence, I'm just wondering what type of conditions are likely to be applied to licences, and could the Minister possibly give some examples of these and how would compliance with conditions be monitored and resourced?
I thank Monica Lennon for her question. I think it is, as I've mentioned in previous answers to other members, for the local authority proposing the scheme, but also for Scottish ministers, or to determine whether they consider it appropriate for that examination to be initiated. But the provisions in the Regulations and Act don't constrain why an examination might be initiated. So ministers and the local authority make the decision on whether to initiate that examination, but only after the local authority has completed its own consultation and its own impact assessments and proposes a scheme to be made. And I think it would be inappropriate to speculate on potential reason or scope of examination for schemes, since obviously no such schemes have yet been consulted on or proposed. I don't know if Heather wants to say more on the specifics of the regulation around about your question.
Yeah, if I can just clarify, Minister, because I think maybe that was a different question you answered. So sorry if I wasn't clear. I'm thinking about once a licence has been approved, a bit like when you get a planning consent, you get conditions. Do we know from learning elsewhere what conditions typically look like and then how are they monitored for compliance? Sorry, my dog's barking.
I think in response to your question, it would be for the reporter to determine the process for examination based on the requirements that are set out in the Act. But I might bring Heather in on the specifics.
I think the question is on licensing conditions, and I think my colleague Elizabeth Hawley is happy to come in, and if the member's got specific points, we're probably happy to take it away and write on it. But if I can invite Elizabeth to come in first, if that's okay, Minister.
Yes, just if it helps, just simply looking for examples of what conditions might look like. I know it's a matter for the local authority, but from lessons elsewhere, Notting, for example, do we know what conditions tend to look like?
Yeah, Elizabeth will come in on that just now. Thank you.
Thank you.
I'm not aware of any conditions that Nottingham have placed on their licences that they've issued. Local authorities can make local exemptions. So, for example, Nottingham has exempted small employers under a certain number of car parking spaces. Under the Act, local authorities could also create a WPL that's only in force in certain areas of their local authority boundary, or only at certain days of the week or certain times of the day. So there are local exemptions, and I think that Nottingham has made use of that under the English regulations. In terms of conditions, as I say, I'm not aware of any that Nottingham have imposed, but I'm happy to look into that and double check and write into you if that's helpful.
Yeah, that would be helpful. Thank you very much for that. And yes, was last question then, just thinking about driver behaviour change. I just wondered, Minister, what modelling has been carried out? First of all, to look at the scenario where the levy is passed on by the employer to workers, and the scenario when it's not passed on to employer. Is there modelling that shows perhaps different outcomes on that?
So I suppose the only example of modelling we would have would be the Nottingham example to compare it to. So I don't know if officials are cited on this. I don't have that in front of me. Apologies to Monica Lennon, but I can certainly ask officials to share it with her. But I guess the Nottingham example is the best one that we know of, and therefore the modelling would exist because it's already in place and has been for some time now. If officials can confirm if we have that data, I'd be happy to share that with the member. I don't have it in front of me. Apologies.
I'm happy to come in. Am I muted? Yeah. I can look at the evidence for the Nottingham. I know that there has been some evaluation and assessment of the Nottingham scheme. In terms of the modelling that local authorities would do in Scotland, you know, we would expect the local authority to sort of look at that as part of their business case ahead of proposing the scheme, and that would help inform the decisions that are within their local scheme in terms of the design and so on.
Thank you. I think it would be helpful for the committee to see any modelling or forecast. So thank you for that. I'm happy to hand back to you, convener.
Thanks very much, Monica. Jackie Dunbar to be followed by Graeme Simpson. Jackie, over to you.
Thank you, convener. It's more for clarification, if you don't mind, because we've heard some questioning today, and I'm just a little bit worried that there might be some confusion with people in regards to who would actually be responsible for paying the licence. So if I can get some clarification from the Minister, my understanding is that it's the occupier of the premises who would be liable for it.
Yeah.
And I am aware that some companies are currently charging for spaces. Would that have the roll-on effect? So would that be any different to what's being proposed? Don't know if I've made that any easier or simpler.
No, I thank Jackie Dunbar for her question. So she's right, employers would pay an annual levy to the council for every parking space that they have, and that would be for the employer to decide whether or not they pass on that charge or not to their employees. So I think it is important to make that differentiation around about the role of local authorities here and the role additionally of local employers, and then how employees will experience the charge, or they may not, because of course their employer may decide not to pass on that charge. Officials again may want to come in on the specifics of the regulations here in terms of some of the confusion that Jackie Dunbar spoke to potentially.
Thank you.
Yes, Minister. The regulations cover the circumstances in which persons other than the occupier of premises would be liable to obtain a licence and pay the licence charge. So that covers, for example, the situation where the member asked about, where an employer who perhaps leases parking spaces from another provider, and so where there is sufficient evidence of the parking arrangements between the provider and the employer, then the requirement were passed from the occupier to the employer in that circumstance, and the regulations cover this.
Okay, thank you. I think I got most of that. Heather was very, very soft, so I think I got most of it. Thank you, convener.
Thanks very much, Jackie. Graeme Simpson, please.
Thanks, convener. Going back on Nottingham, the Nottingham scheme. And just out of information, just over half of companies involved in that scheme, I think it's just over 50%, pass on the charge to their employees. So that's just a fact. So that goes back to your very first question, actually, convener. My question, though, is something different. Minister, I can't see anything in the regulations or the Parent Act that sets a limit on what councils can charge for a licence. Can you help me there?
Well, I thank Mr Simpson for his question. So he first of all raises the scheme in Nottingham, which, as we've discussed today, has been running since 2012, and it has helped to generate, I think, a fall of 40 million car miles over 15 years. But I think it's also worth saying that in its first 6 years of operation, it raised £53 million, which of course was ring-fenced for the following transport improvements. So, for example, there were two further lines on the Nottingham Express Transit tram system, the upgrading of passenger facilities at Nottingham Station, and ongoing support for Link Bus network additionally. And I know when the scheme was introduced, Mr Simpson was really keen that we needed to empower councils and give them, I think he said, a renewed sense of meaning and purpose. So I hope he supports the legislation and the ability for local authorities to make this decision. And that, I think, brings me to his question on the limit and the role of ministers or Scottish Government setting that limit. It is, of course, for local authorities to take a view on the limit that will be reached in terms of whatever they want to set the fee or the charge at, rather. I think it's important that the responsibility for local authorities to look at their own local circumstances and decide what that might be. Officials may want to say more on this. Apologies.
I think just to add the consultation requirements that are on local authorities. So they have to set out what their scheme entails, which would include the charge that a local authority proposes. And that all then needs to form part of the consultation of the impact assessments, which the regulation sets out the requirements for how local authorities must then make that information available. Thank you.
Thanks, convener. I'm quite astonished by that. So the minister and her official have just confirmed that there is no limit whatsoever on what councils can charge for a licence, no limit whatsoever. So that will frighten the life out of businesses across Scotland. In fact, the Scottish Chambers of Commerce and Glasgow Chamber of Commerce, Glasgow being one of the cities where this could be introduced, saying this levy should be scrapped or at least put on hold while we recover from the pandemic. Is that not something the Minister has considered?
I'm listening to Mr Simpson's question. I think some of what he's suggesting is on the margins of scaremongering. In terms of the costs that will be incurred locally, this is a matter for local authorities to decide upon. You know, if I was to come and set a top limit for this, I would be accused of interfering with local democratic principles. We've got to get the balance right here. And I think that it's really important that local authorities are trusted to look at their local circumstances. They will consider any application through their own consultation processes. They will look at the needs of the communities that they represent. And therefore, I would expect them to set an appropriate cost accordingly.
Okay, thank you, Mr. Simpson.
And I think, sorry, convener, convener, the regulations on penalty charges are also in line with any other penalty charges. So the manner of issuing, increased charges for late payment, information on penalty charge notices, for example. So I think I would be concerned that Mr. Simpson is potentially fear-mongering on this issue. I absolutely trust local authorities to set these at an appropriate level. But at a level that is right for the needs of the communities they represent.
One very final point, Mr. Simpson.
I'm not scaremongering. There is a difference between penalty charges. You're right, Minister, to mention them. I think the maximum penalty charge for non-compliance is £5,000. There's a difference between that and what I was asking about, which was the charge for the licence, and there isn't, as you've confirmed, an upper limit for that. I'll leave it there.
Yeah, thank you. Minister, one final, I just wanted to follow up on the point made about not the Scottish Government not imposing limits on local authorities. But of course, if you look at council tax by comparison, there was a limit imposed on what local authorities could do with council tax in terms of the upper increase amount. So why not follow that similar approach and have a limit on what local authorities can impose through the working parking levy?
The convener will appreciate that I was not in post when this legislation was brought forward, but I can certainly bring forward or share with the committee the rationale behind the reasoning as to why we did not introduce a limit in this regard.
Right. That would be appreciated. But you can see the concerns about this, not on paper, but by regulation, this being unlimited. You can see how potentially this could cause some concern for businesses large and small throughout the country who might have to pay this.
I hear what the convener is saying, and I'd be more than happy to share the detail of why that